I have a lot of great reporters, investigative journalists, but we don't have enough. And so for days, we've had the Colin Powell emails from the hackers, obviously. And just pouring through them, I was personally looking at the Bohemian Grove emails yesterday. And I said, give it to Watson, but he's overwhelmed. He's been working 7 days a week, 18 hours a day. Or I said, one of you guys can write on it. And then, boom, I woke up this morning, and there it was, Breitbart. Bohemian Grove wants to stop Donald Trump. The establishment Republicans, just one more delicious cherry telling me how good Donald Trump is on top of things. If that group of effete, and I'm not saying everyone that goes there is bad. Obviously, a lot of people are guessed. I mean, folks like Clint Eastwood, you know, him goes. It's beautiful. It's nice. You can use it year-round if you're a member. It's the stuff that goes on in July that's weird. But if you just sit there and look at Bohemian Grove alone, and they're totally freaking out over Donald Trump saying they're going to vote for Hillary Clinton, and they quote, Trump will be a disaster. Well, that's because there's special interests that have hijacked this country. Whether you call it Trilateral Commission, CFR, Bilderberg Group, Bohemian Grove, it's all the same players that run those groups that are basically running our country and running Europe into the ground and starting all these wars and playing both sides and being totally amoral. And then they've got a huge hard-on for Americana, and because it threatens them, even though they've hijacked it and become basically kings of the world, they stole it, so they want to destroy it, even though it gives them their power. And that's the globalist fundamental sin. The head of the IMF came out yesterday, Legrand, or whatever that stupid lady's name is that I have to look at for years, that said the French have to work 7 days a week and all the rest is garbage, and that people should pay more taxes. She came out and said globalism needs to distribute more wealth or its promise will be lost. Globalism was set up to screw everyone over. It's a eugenics-based planetary program. But yes, college students and people that get inducted into it get told we're going to save the world. It's going to be like Starfleet with the Captain Kirk flying around saving everybody. Legrand slams globalization, warns of a groundswell of discontent when they're the ones that are engineering the discontent, and we even have their stinking emails with George Soros and her planning all this stuff. I mean, it's incredible. You people are scum. And you think you're better than everybody, and you want to destroy prosperity because you don't want to compete with anybody? Go to hell. People are through. They're done. So I've got masses of news, and Tim Kennedy's coming on today. This kind of dropped my lap last week. You know, friends with Tim and, you know, Shane. And Tim, for a couple of years, started using Super Male Vitality off and on. Then he went and got checked to make sure he was allowed to with the anti-doping agency. They came and tested him 4 times in 1 day. And they said, no, this, you know, these herbs, you're allowed to take them. And he says it's really helped him. But that's not why he's coming on to plug Super Male Vitality today. But this all kind of happened by accident. He's coming on to tell you about the next big fight, which has still not been confirmed anywhere. It'll be confirmed here coming up when Tim Kennedy is in studio with us. Sometime in the third hour, because he's literally only working out twice today at fight camp down the street. He's going to come over here. So stay with us. We have Tim Kennedy, the Army sniper, Green Beret, patriot, friend of the show, coming on to announce the new big national fight that's been so heavily anticipated for several years. And so he wants to announce it here. We're honored to have him announce it here. He's also one of the hosts and one of the investigators on Hunting Hitler. Long bio, obviously, for Tim Kennedy. He's going to be popping in. And then we have Anthony Cumia, who, of course, hosts his own program. And it was basically kicked off XM and his former show for being a Trump supporter. He's going to be hosting the fourth hour today from, is it from New York or Florida? I know he lives both places. So that's coming up today. when I particularly have big stacks of news, it tends to almost make me calm down. It's like I'm sitting down for Thanksgiving supper or something. There's just so much to cover. It's almost daunting. We're going to do our best here to cover it all. Here's the first thing I want to say today, just in retrospect. We are seeing the fall of the establishment right now. We're seeing their arrogance, their hubris, cave in on them. And even if they pull false flags and are able to steal the election, they will basically only make it that much worse for themselves. The problem is studying them, watching them, looking at the psychology, the criminology, and talking to a lot of other experts. They concur with my view, or I could say we share the view and the belief and the understanding, unfortunately, that they're not going to turn loose of power without almost any level of crisis you can imagine. And so it really is up to the military and this, quote, security services and others to decide whether you want to lose the prosperity and have America completely collapse so that George Soros and a few other weirdo globalists who think that they're messiahs can piss on you and your family. Because I'm not even going to talk to you like you're moral. I know some are, some aren't. But this is end of the line for America. And that's why you're seeing all these amazing things happen. That's why you're seeing all these documents come out exposing the Clintons and the Democrats and the globalists and the Republican Party. Because anybody on this planet that bleeds red blood and cares about their children knows that true evil is nesting and growing and incubating in Washington, D.C., in New York, in places like Los Angeles, with these totally disconnected globalists who hijacked America, took over the planet with America's ingenuity and brawn and courage and guts. And are so threatened by the spirit of America, though, that they want to finally basically bring the republic to heel. These are very, very destructive, very, very degenerate people. They don't like honor. They don't like wealth. They don't like real power. They don't like real confidence. They run from it like vampires run from the crack of dawn. And America is finding its spirit again, and other countries are finding its spirit as well, because we're identifying the global corporate combines that are establishing this planetary government. And once those are identified, and once you know that the French socialists, almost all of them, have been caught with Swiss bank accounts, as they raise the middle class taxes to 101%, and you go, well, that's crazy. That'll destroy everybody. That's the plan. They are robbing you. They're leaving you with nothing. They are absolutely full of criminal energy. And if you want to know what the country's going to look like, it's France. Totally invaded with groups that hate Western culture because the globalists hate Western culture. Because it's antithetical to what they're going to build. We now have more Guccifer 2.0 documents coming out. Obama sold off public offices to donors. You know, it's funny how the globalists built this giant NSA panopticonic surveillance grid, and then they thought they would control it. They didn't know that people that are at the telecoms, you name it, know how to just jack right into it themselves and take anything they want. You people built glass houses for everybody, and then you're the ones committing the crimes. Not a very smart move, Dumbo. What do you think the agencies find out when they snoop around Alex Jones? Somebody dedicated 18 hours a day, fighting hard, taking on tyrants, being infiltrated, being attacked mercilessly, and never stopping. That's honorable. We get admired. People break into your emails, they find a bunch of scum shelling us out, who hate their own children, who are basically devil worshipers. People don't want to be ruled and run by you. And of course, you know that. You are spiritually very, very twisted, witch-like creatures. So as I plunge into the news here, all of you that have signed up with the New World Order, all of you that are going along with this globalist system are insane. Because you're fooling yourselves, you're lying to yourselves that you're a winner because you signed up with the devil. Lemon on CNN, who is one of the most sycophantic pro-Clinton people I've ever seen, even laughed when Hillary came out and said, I've been the most transparent candidate in presidential election history. Just like the outgoing State Department spokesman started laughing and freaking out and having a breakdown and said, can you tell it's my last day at work? And the guy's laughing like it's funny, but you can tell he's actually totally freaked out and realizes that he has betrayed his name, his family, his children, and everybody, and has signed on to a bunch of wicked, horrible, evil people. I mean, Hillary Clinton, folks, they don't have animals. They don't give people tips. They don't have gardens. They don't go out to the beach. Remember how weird Bill Clinton would look, you know, at the beach like a zombie? Even before he got sick, because these are demons, ladies and gentlemen. These aren't normal people. And they don't let the Secret Service look them in the face. If you're a maid in the White House and you look at Hillary, you're fired the next day. These are entitled, bloated, weak, rotting, sick filth. And Hillary calls me dark-hearted, because the truth is, my heart's the opposite of that. And she knows I see her very, very clearly. But it's not the Russians that are hacking the majority of the emails. The Russians tell you when they've done it, like the UN emails where they were hiding the decline in temperature and setting up global carbon taxes. Thank God Russia did that. But I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen, it's people inside the DNC, and it's people inside federal agencies, just like Snowden. That's where almost all this is coming from. It's coming directly from the government agencies that the New World Order set up to totally game the economy and take over society. Because make no mistake, the NSA is not first and foremost about spying on people and their basic little political activities. It's about spying on whole movements, understanding trends so you can get ahead of them. Future predictive programming. And you know what's happened? They've run the permutations with these systems and found that the current course that the Obamas and the Clintons and the Bushes and that group has us on basically ends in World War III. And so everyone that isn't on a suicide mission like Hillary Clinton to destroy the planet sits there and goes, well, yeah, okay, we can basically predict the future now. We have the systems, we have the technology, and it tells us that we are really evil and we are the bad guys. Wow, the NSA discovered that America is run by the New World Order and that we're the bad guys. But we can be resurrected like the Phoenix, like Christ. We can be reborn politically and as a nation the minute we admit that and repent of it and start locking these globalists up. And I mean, go in there and grab George Soros and haul his ass in front of a, you know, jury. And after you put this guy's life on, you know, and it's not some personal thing to sit here and say, we need to lock up George Soros. It needs to be said. I don't particularly want to take on this guy. He's a mass murdering criminal that's destabilized more than 40 countries and brags about it. He is a demon incarnate. But I must take the field politically against him and just say that political means must lead to justice. And it's time for these people to be brought down. I was watching the news this morning. Fox News is as bad as CNN now, saying that Homeland Security is very concerned. They're sure the Russians are breaking into the computers and the Russians are going to steal it for Trump. Of course, because even in fake polls, Trump is 6 points ahead in USA Today polls and LA Times polls and CNN polls. He's 6 points ahead. I told you, folks, he was 10, 15 points ahead in real polls months ago. He had a landslide of support after the RNC. It was a total royal flush victory. So they came out and put out fake polls with fake samples. So people started thinking, well, Trump's really losing, so he wouldn't gain momentum. It's all a mind game, but that mind game fell in. All right, here's here's what I want to do. I want to open the phones up today throughout the entire broadcast for first-time callers or folks that haven't called in a year or so, and really try to actually go to your phone calls. But it's going to be on topic. Hillary's collapse, the collapse of the system, the collapse of confidence in the globalist system. Will they stage a false flag? This is a huge topic area. How are they going to try to spin this? I mean, you can see their spin machine is in full gear, but people are conscious now more and more. They see through it. Like mainstream news for the first 2 days would only show her when she first wobbles a little bit and says, oh, she just stumbled. What's the big deal? Deceiving their viewers on CNN, MSNBC, ABC, you name it, not showing her totally fall over and be drugged into the vehicle, clearly having a seizure. She's having a seizure. Doctors that see the video say it's a seizure. We've all been in the grocery store or at the hike and bike trail or at church and somebody falls out and has a seizure. We've all been in school. I remember in first grade, this cute girl that was always at the front row, what was her name, Sarah, I think, got up, walked over to the pencil sharpener, started having a seizure, her head went in circles, and she fell over. And the teacher knew that that was in her medical record, that she had epilepsy. I mean, okay, we've all had to deal with this. It could happen to any of us. The point is, they're lying about it constantly, and it's getting worse. The Secret Service doesn't know what's causing it, they told us a month ago. They don't know, because it's all so secretive. And it's getting worse, and they're going to have to make an announcement. And now you see those preparations, and the Democrats are just hoping they can push this through. But Hillary is the leader of the Democrats with Bill. They really are globalist puppets, but they know where all the bodies are buried. They're kind of like free agents. And so she's refusing to step down. And yes, folks, that's the word from our sources, that they've already told Hillary, we need to do something now, we need to punt now, and Hillary is not doing it. So we have this total facade moment where it just blows over. It's like a billboard that looks like a house, but a big wind comes by and it blows over, and you go, oh, that was a billboard. It was an optical illusion. That's already happened. What do they do? What are they going to pull next? Look, if they'll cut a video and deceive their viewers and say nothing really happened, they'll do anything. They've lied so many times, they don't care anymore. And just like North Koreans compete with each other to see who can grovel more to the dear leader, these sycophantic TV hosts do it. But more and more people like Dr. Drew won't do it. And Sanjay Gupta, to his credit, says these aren't medical records she just released. She's clearly got serious medical problems. There's a cover-up going on. I guess he'll be fired next. What, are you going to fire everybody because they tell the truth? Where's Rachel Maddow? Where is Anderson Cooper? Where are all these people now that just a week ago were attacking me by name and saying that I was a liar and that I had just made up health problems that didn't exist? She was in the hospital for a year in 2012 and 13, off and on. No one is the creator of the conspiracy theory. Her health history, and her looking so ill, and her dodging all those subpoenas, and her doddering around and clearly declining, that's where the story came from. Yes, Matt Drudge was the first to ask the question, is she sick? Because you could see her in testimony, she looked like a truck had run her over. Hillary Clinton looks pretty good, looks healthy. I wouldn't call her an attractive woman, but energy, spunky, pre-2012. She's running around overthrowing innocent countries, murdering people, making jokes about it, you know, good old witch criminal. And then the hand of doom keeps up, you know, with her actions, and she runs into that brick wall, and boom, she's not as arrogant anymore, and Matt Drudge starts putting up the pictures saying, is Hillary sick? And the media goes, oh, how ridiculous, is Hillary sick? Then she disappears for a year. Drudge keeps saying, where's Hillary? And they're like, oh, that kook over there that, you know, is asking where Hillary is. I mean, anyone could look at her and say she looks like a cancer patient, because that's the word. And now when we come back, here's the big story. Hacked emails. We've got them. Breitbart's got them. It's up on Infowars.com of Colin Powell, former Secretary of State, talking to the former Defense Secretary of Canada. And he's in there talking about all sorts of stuff, about how sick she is. But then if you go past that, the latest emails are the Bohemian Grove. The big Republican shindig, the establishment Republican, the leftist Republican shindig, And I mean, when I say leftist, I mean, Nixon had the name for it. And that's fine. You know, consenting adults can do whatever they want. But it's basically, at least a few weeks out of the year, a big gay orgy. Believe me, I've been there. They were chasing me around, whistling at me. I know. It sounds crazy. A lot of new viewers and listeners don't know that. It's pretty famous. There's been TV shows, History Channel, Discovery Channel about it. That's a whole other separate issue. We're going to come back and cover all this straight ahead. Because it's very, very important that this is more proof the establishment absolutely hates Donald J. Trump. I mean, this is beautiful. The special interests are so entitled, like social justice warriors, that on a massive scale, that they really think the presidency and the Congress and the country belongs to them. They really think they're big inventive geniuses to sell our jobs off to China and set up trade deals where we can't compete. And then, well, they've got a deal with the Chinese general they've had going for 30 years and make $1 billion and then Buffy can go to the best schools. And boy, aren't we Ivy League geniuses? No, you're called traitors. You're called pieces of trash. And let's be clear, it isn't like you sold out to some superior empire that was going to come and make things better. You want to make things worse in your cosmology of eugenics. Because that's how you manage us. The truth is, we're coming down fast, but we're miles above you. And your attempt to dominate the human spirit is your greatest crime. And you have failed. The cracks in your defense system are irrevocable. The gravity pull of liberty will now crush you. The question is, how long is it going to take until you surrender? Now, I want to be clear. I'm not pushing some utopia here. The globalists push a utopia, which is actually a dystopic nightmare if you really look at it and study their own plans. A utopia for them, they say, sounds like a nightmare, but a true dystopic system for us. So these special interests think you belong to them, and they've projected a spirit of sleep, a spirit of delusion, a spirit of pettiness. They've created the most empty, ugly culture they can, and it's declassified. They did it on purpose. Working with the big foundations, working with Hollywood, to kill the beauty in your soul. And you could say we've been in a desert period, very arid, very dry, very hot, not a lot of life, but here comes the rain. Here she comes again. I love the rain. I love the rain. And you watch the life come back to the desert and that bloom. There's nothing more beautiful than a desert spring. When the floods come and wash away the detritus. There won't be a utopia on the other side of that, but it's damn close compared to the New World Order system. And we have a lot to repair. Humanity is damaged. In fact, we're far, far from completing this war. But I can tell you, the tide has turned. So make no mistake how bad things get in the future. What matters is this species on the other side is going to make it through it with God's help, with your prayers and your action. So I want to open the phones up for callers, specifically on the wide, huge thoroughfare of this election, the state of the world. I think they're going to pull some false flags. I think they're going to pull an assassination attempt on Hillary. I'm telling you, I just feel it. Wow. But I don't even have anxiety anymore because I felt it building the last few years. You all felt it now. There's not even more anxiety because we're in the battle. It's like, it's on. We're here. And it's a spirit. Spirit of liberty versus a spirit of oppression, spirit of tyranny. And a lot of people think they're Christians, but they can't really be in the presence of real freedom, to be in the presence of real liberty, to be in the presence of God. Because it's too big, it's too deep, it's too wide, it's too complex, it's too frightening to them. because I guess their timid souls just can't handle the truth. They're not designed, some of these people, to drink from these waters. And so they'll never know. And I personally sit there and try to understand the like mystery of Calvinistic thinking. And I don't particularly think that that thought of Calvinism is complete or absolutely correct. Whereas you're predestined, but also have free will. But these people have a will to hurt innocents, and a will to try to make people poor, and a will to try to pull things down. They're demonic. And again, I have hundreds of stories, incredible news, but I just get back to the bedrock foundation here that the globalists really are horrible, evil, wicked, despicable, jealous, envious creatures that really do just want to overthrow creation. I mean, look at how they attack the sacred union of man and woman. That deepest, oldest of bonds that took us and our ancestors through all of the incredible tribulations this species has faced. The bonds that were forged, the oaths that were sworn. And we see the globalists destroying our families, destroying our children, attacking such a noble species as ours, trying to make us ignoble so that these creatures can feel better about themselves. Because when they look at us, when these psychopaths look at us, they feel low. Because they are low. All right, let me get to some of these news stories. There's a lot of them here. But I mean, I tell you, I look at Hillary Clinton, and I look at an arrogant, power-tripping servant of darkness, chosen by spiders far more wicked than her to command the forces of evil. Don't you think the globalists would want to find someone better spoken, better looking, more honorable to lead their system? But they can't find people who are honorable to do it. They will not do it. They cannot do it. And so we have crones like Madeleine Albright visited upon us. Zero honor in her body. Saved from the Nazis by the Serbs. Lived there until she was a teenager. And then ran to the United States like George Soros with stolen Jewish loot. Loot that her father stole from Jews. Think about this. Think of these people. We have Madeleine Albright, who is just like George Soros. She has been caught with $10 million paintings in her house stolen from Jews that were killed. She's a Jew. She gets on TV and says 500,000 dead Iraqis are a good price to pay, really being herself, Iraqi children. Can we cue that up? I think you reminded me of it. You put it up on screen. I mean, just imagine. You, like, broker all these Jews trying to get out for the Nazis, double-cross them, kill them, get their family jewels, their real family jewels are sent off to be killed, you get all the loot, and then you run to Serbia and they save you, and then you come and run bombing campaigns against them to bring Muslims in. It's like, oh, here, let me save you, Madeline. Oh, thank you. Ah, I mean, it's like, and you say, this doesn't make sense. Why attack the people that save you? That's because it's evil. It's like even sicker and more fun to screw over the people that saved you. See how that works? And so you start getting into their mindset and you go, oh my God, these people are literal spawn of hell. Hillary Clinton, born into this country with this incredible rich past and all of our swashbuckling and everything and our inventions. And I mean, the whole world, from the Japanese to the Russians to the French to people in African countries. You know, come and see America and say, these people are incredible. They don't put up with crap. You know, people stand up. People are involved. People kill each other in the streets. Whatever, doesn't matter. We're real. And then she gets all this power being brought up in this system, and then she hates it. She hates the very environment that gave her all this power. It's like the devil created the most beautiful, powerful, second only to God. But then Lucifer looks at God and says, but you're everything. I could never even be you, so I want to go make my own thing. I want to go, but you can't even make anything, Lucifer. So you have to go hijack something else God made. And God sits back and says, okay, you go ahead and try to break my creation that's made in my image. And that's why Lucifer doesn't like us, folks, because we're made, and you can see it all, what we build, what we do, in the image of the entity that created everything. And we're just larvae right now, ladies and gentlemen. We're being tested. We're being prepared. We're in boot camp right now. These people think they're winners. They went and sold out to the beast system. They sold out to the New World Order. They think they're getting ahead because they're part of that. You just failed. Big, fat F minus. A big, fat zero. It's amazing. The eyes not seen, the ears not heard, what God's got in store for us. Can you imagine the other side, the next level? This level's pretty amazing right here, I got to tell you. But I just love God. And no matter what happens to me, I know it's all part of God's plan. And I have total faith in God. Total faith. And, you know, when I was like 2 or 3 years old, I would get so sad thinking about starving children around the world. And I wasn't even watching shows about that. I could just feel the suffering when I was a little child. And I just prayed to God that someday, somehow, we could try to take more suffering out of the world. And I thought growing up, everybody was like me. I thought everybody wanted to help others. But see, when people have been infected by this globalist system, they're not even conscious anymore. They're like running a satanic program in their brain. And all they want to do is hurt people. We have Albright clip. Here is Madeleine Albright talking about 500,000 children dying with sanctions. It's a good price to pay. Here it is.
We have heard that 500,000 children have died. I mean, that's more children than died in Hiroshima. And you know, is the price worth it?
I think this is a very hard choice, but the price, we think the price is worth it.
Now, you have to understand, and then she goes on from there, her stability quote in the Gulf. That was back when even the corrupt, twisted media was still a little bit more honest because they, you know, at least pretended they weren't deceptive to themselves. Nowadays, they just wouldn't even show that clip. And the media thinks it's like winning because it goes along with this when it's destroying itself. I have another clip. This is Congressman Chaffetz, who I like more and more. With the FBI yesterday, we already played a clip of this yesterday, but I wanted to play this particular clip where he says to the FBI agent that's in there testifying and won't give Congress the field reports, the 302s, and the longer clip explains, listen, we make the laws. This is Congress. So we're not doing a FOIA request for the Judicial Committee, sir. You're going to give it. In fact, here's your subpoena right now. And this is so good. This is Congress waking back up. Now, if you think it's bad to have the FBI under the orders of Loretta Lynch and others, well, that's who's running the FBI right now. If you think that's bad, what about Obama saying he gets the authority to attack countries from NATO, not Congress? And the congressman go, I don't think I'm even hearing this, what I'm hearing right now. Are you joking? And you see, that's why England, who's been a big warmongering group and done a lot of bad things, finally did the right thing a few years ago and said, we're not attacking Syria. They finally, and that's what they say, you know, is the big joke at the end of the day, is that even though England's brutal and has a lot of serious problems, a little bit soft heart at the end, which is good. You got a soft heart for a reason. You don't turn into Hillary Clinton. Have a big rock for a heart and project onto me that I have a dark heart. But they said, really, they're going to exterminate and de-Christianize Syria? That's what this thing is. This is Saudi Arabia. It's already tried it three different times. Is killing every Christian they can. Obama won't let them out of the country. It's 0.4% Christians they let out when the population was 20%. They're not letting Christians out. It's a death trap. And then Obama gave a speech a year ago or so that told me everything I needed to know. I thought we got to find the clip and play it again. Where he relishes, he goes, listen, I mean, I can't do a good Obama impression, but listen, you know, we just can't only let Christians in. We got to be fair and let, you know, Muslims in, you know, from this region who've been hurt. They don't let Shiites in. Less than 1%, even though Shiites are 20% or more in Syria. They're 20% worldwide. I think it's like 30-something percent in Syria. They don't let but maybe 1% of them in, and it's 0.4. Look it up, Christians. They don't let them out. They're killing them. And, of course, MI6 went in there, and they actually briefed them. They said, this is the U.S. plan. This is what's going on. We're conducting a genocide, just like the Armenian genocide that the Turks conducted. And the House of Commons said, we're not going to be part of that. See, it's gotten so evil now that they march in and say, the operation to de-Christianize Syria is ongoing, Commander. We only need the funding for the next flotilla and the attack fleets are ready. They're like, we're killing all the Christians? Yes, as part of the organized program launched by Lord Soros. I mean, this is what's going on behind the scenes. They're like, well, certainly you agree to the plan. We've launched it against Russia as well. Our programs are going well in the schools here. The nation is almost 100% anti-Christian now. And they're sitting back at their chairs going, they're kind of, whoa, we actually are doing it. We're falling. We're killing our countries. We're killing the engine of our strength. Why? Because a hunchback George Soros wants to. That's why. Yeah, only 56 of 10,000 Syrian refugees led into the U.S. are Christian. Do the math. It's 0.4% last time I did it. Might have changed. Out of 10,801, 56 are Christian. That's half of 1%. So now they say 0.5. I guess after the hue and cry, I'm going to skip this break. Oh, it's not good to skip that music. This is the epic moment we have reached. People say to me, they either say, oh, you're a horrible opportunist, you're this evil person, oh, lying about the loving government, the media, or they say, oh, you have so much courage, you're so wonderful. We have a pack of vampires trying to take over, and I've got courage that I'm fighting them? If a big, mean guy busted through that door and was attacking people, I couldn't keep myself from going over and fighting them. And it's not because I've got courage. It's not because I'm a tough guy. It's default. And maybe there's something wrong with me then, because I just can't imagine running. But for a public that's never, I guess, gone through any rites of passage, I could see how people think running is the way to get away from things, but it's not. Because if somebody was coming to get me, they're going to keep coming. I need to face them down. Now, maybe if it's not the best time or I could think things out, I'd slip away. But confronted with it head on, it's a switch gets flipped. And we need to flip that switch right now. And sometimes I'll have family come to town or whatever. They'll go, man, that's getting pretty rough on you. Huh? I saw front page of the paper the last 3 days attacking you. And yeah, and I saw on TV there. How are you holding up under it? I'm like, frickin' popping champagne bottles if you want to get down to brass tacks. I mean, figuratively, I haven't had any champagne in a while. I don't really like champagne, but to have traitors attacking you and me and Trump and everybody else, man, that is a great honor. So the toll-free number to join us on false flags, what is Hillary going to pull? You agree the facade is collapsing. What do you think about the next 53 days till this epic election? super epic, I mean, gargantuan, historical, unprecedented. This will be a day long remembered. I mean, I don't know how you highlight this as the big one. Most important election, I think, in U.S. history. Everything on the table. The globalists admitting they're all in. World government in peril. They're hitting the panic alert buttons. And notice as we get more bold, good men and women in government can be more bold now. People will say, oh, and I want to explain something fundamental. I'm not kissing the butt of the government. I'm a constitutionalist. I want a very small constitutional government. I'm supporting and praising good people in government that are sending good signals, doing good things, putting their neck out there. That means those individuals. And quite frankly, we can get mad at TSA agents all day, and boy, have I. But as I mature, I just go, you know, it is the bad folks in Congress. And it is the people that set these policies up and left our borders wide open. That's where this started. So why should I just sit here and attack the actual TSA people? Because that's just a cop-out. It's easy to attack the little TSA person. I need to attack myself for letting this happen. I need to actually go after people that did it. And so, quite frankly, I didn't turn to the side of the police. I was never against the police. I was angry at seeing unconstitutional stuff happening and knowing the corruption of the police was happening by the globalists and the ADL, the Southern Poverty Law Center, brainwashing them with anti-American, Soviet-level, anti-free speech garbage. And now the police, even the FBI, doesn't get their info from the Southern Poverty Law Center and ADL now. Most police departments will begrudgingly take the award politically, but it's a laughing stock and no one believes it. So the police, on average, did the right thing. They're for the Republic, so that's good. And, of course, George Soros wants his people to go shoot him in the back of the head. You know, that's what's going on here, folks, a war for the country. We can reform the police later, but you're not going to reform them running around saying shoot them in the back of the head. You're going to turn them into a paramilitary force that the globalists think they can then capture and use against the patriots. No, 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 no. If George Soros wants you to hate the police, you shouldn't hate him. Try going up and talking to him, being nice to him, finding out what's going on. That's how we have humanity. That's how we change this. That's how we turn this around. That's how we defeat the New World Order. My greatest work is with you that have magnified our information and helped us with the information. Is that we really have painted a very clear picture of what's going on. And as things get revealed, people go, wow, it really is a clear picture. Alex really knew. Well, of course, I do this 15 hours a day. I interview all the top experts. I live this. And for whatever reason, genetically, in my whole family line on both sides, this is what arises every time there's a political need. We might go generations before there's a big crisis, but every time there is, my ancestors, right back to the start, have done things, some of them bigger than what I've done. And you have that as well, but you have to activate the genetics you have to understand you already have the battle plans. You already know how to counter the enemy. You already have everything you need. Your ancestors already overcame things, in many cases, much worse than we face. All right, I'm going to play this Chaffetz clip because it's very important, and it's government. The real government, the Congress that holds the purse strings, not supposed to be co-equal. Now they say the presidency's all powerful or the UN. See, they're devolving the power in the wrong direction. It's Congress. Congress. At first, it's the states. Got about 51% of the power. Then of the 49%, I'd say a good 20% of that is supposed to really be going to Congress. That's what the founders said. It's how it works. And then it's the courts and then the president. The president executes. He's an executive. He executes what the board tells him to do. The president, presidents don't run companies. That's ass backwards. The shareholders. We're the shareholders. We're the stakeholders. We're the Americans. We hold it. We do. We're about to get a CEO, a president that wants to do that, get ready to kick ass. He knows he's got the team that's still unstoppable, that they've tried to teach it's a wimp and sit there and hunch over like it's a nobody. Truth is, 1776 is about to go supernova. Let's go to this clip.
This is the House Governmental Oversight Committee, chaired by Congressman Jason Chaffetz, is furious that the FBI has released selected portions of its file about Mrs. Clinton. Mm-hmm. At the same time the FBI was being interrogated by Congressman Chaffetz, his opposite number in the Senate, Senator Grassley, the chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee, was making a speech about the same thing.
Okay, so both bodies are upset. Quickly, go ahead.
How did the FBI decide what to keep secret and what to release, and how can they do that to the Congress?
Will the FBI provide to Congress the full file with no redactions of personal identifiable information?
I cannot make that commitment sitting here today.
Then I'm going to issue a subpoena, and I'm going to do it right now. So let's go. I've signed this subpoena. We want all the 302s, and we would like the full file. You can accept service on behalf of the FBI?
Certainly.
You are hereby served.
You know what I like about Chaffetz? His hand is shaking there. And that's okay, because the FBI is dangerous. I mean, let's FBI basically runs a show in this country, and they're run by criminals now. And he's standing up against these criminals. He's got big huevos. I want to go to your phone calls for the next 30 minutes, and then Tim Kennedy is set to be coming off fight camp and to announce his new big fight exclusively here. Other folks have kind of halfway leaked it, even though they weren't supposed to till today. This is when he's contractually able to do it. It's basically Tim's belief that basically no one in the UFC is clean but him. I know personally that he's been tested 6 or 7 times this year. In fact, in a 2-day period, he got tested 4 different times. They cannot believe the guy's clean. He is on Super Male Vitality, and I didn't even plug anything last hour, and I skipped a break. And quite frankly, I have a lot of great reporters here that I'd like to give bonuses to for the great work they're doing. I'd like to hire more reporters. I like to, you know, it's really important when you buy the books, the videos, the nutraceuticals, the products at InfoWarsStore.com, because that's what funds this operation. You have to understand. If we're like a fighter bomber flying in to, you know, nuke the enemy, we've got to have fuel put in the engine. We've got to have engine parts. We've got to have, you know, people back there picking the targets on the ground. There's a lot of infrastructure behind things, and you are that. So you really need Super Male Vitality. You really need Lung Cleanse. You really need DNA Force. I mean, everybody really needs these products. I mean, I don't claim to be some beach boy, but I got really confident because I used to run 6 miles almost every other day and lift weights, and I was in super good shape. And I got into media at 21 and just quit working out by about 23. And then I gained almost 100 pounds in the next decade.
Yeah.
Gained 10 pounds a year, boom. You end up, you know, you're a whale. And I'm not attacking people that are fat. I get it. I've been there. So I still got a big giant head and stuff. So on TV, it may not look like I've lost that much weight, but I have lost. I've got pretty close to a 6-pack now. Actually did before I went to Cleveland, and I gained like 10 pounds. I've lost about 7 pounds of it again, but that's right before I went to Cleveland. That's working out less than I was working out just 3-4 years ago. It's the X2 iodine. It's the Super Male Vitality. If I just take it every day, because I've never been a nutraceutical guy. And I started, you know, obviously had sponsors that were funding us. I knew nutraceuticals were important. I mean, I knew supplements were important, but I just never really got into them. And, you know, I was a guy that just go to the buffet at the cafeteria, and I, you know, that was my supplements. I'll eat, you know, 5 plates of food. But the truth is that it's changed my life. And I finally have gotten to where I take my products religiously. And I give them to my kids, and they're healthier, they're happier, you name it. Whether it's our sleep aid knockout or whether it's our oil of oregano, just super organic from the Mediterranean, ozonated olive oil for your face and body, oxy powder to flush out, the liver cleanse, it's all back in stock right now. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. We're running a special 50% off on Make America Free Again, a knockoff of the Trump stuff. I want to get those out to everybody. That's an unprecedented 50% off on those Made in America hats. Make America Free Again. We are no longer have the special for $9 for the Hillary for Prison shirt. But it's a limited edition. It's about to sell out. We'll have the next edition, probably the final edition. So if you want to get those, they're $19.95. That supports the broadcast. But we are running a Super Male Vitality special. 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. 20% off. My transformation with Super Male Vitality has been the real deal. You can see the dramatic differences in my before and after photos. We probably put those on the website, too. To help you get started with your transformation, we're giving you 20% off Super Male Vitality for a limited time at InfoWarsLife.com. While supplies last, just read some of the 5-star reviews on InfoWarsLife.com and see how listeners have transformed their bodies with Super Male Vitality. I want to explain something. We take the safest known herbs and extracts that are known to supercharge and not mimic testosterone, but get your glands to release. And no one really knows how it works. It's God's magic. But this is all just the cornucopia of the best stuff out there. I mean, everybody knows this is on the back of listum, the herbs that are known for thousands of years. Be associated with fertility, strength, manhood, you name it. We have the female vitality as well. It's almost the same formula. But the point is that this is called press into basically an oil. No one else does this. So it's got the essence. We go through hell. That's why it's sold out a lot, because it's hard to source. And you get it where it's wet. And it stays wet. It's not like we're dry, we make it wet. It's always wet. It's always fresh. And then put into the bottle like wine. And then it's saved. And then it just gets better. We are back live. Coming up, Tim Kennedy is going to give us the exclusive first statement on the fight that Rashad Evans went ahead and announced yesterday, a day before he was supposed to, for the next big middleweight fight. They said this would be one of the most anticipated fights ever. Obviously, it's in Madison Square Garden. The whole thing's crazy. First time in New York where they've legalized it. And so this is going to be just something else. Tim Kennedy, by the way, works like 18 hours a day, and he's running around training police departments for free in counter-sniper training, and works out like three times a day, and then goes and like fight 30 black belts in a night. And my crew's actually gone with him. It's crazy. I think the guy trains too much. I mean, it's just unbelievable. Talk about a maniac. He is on another planet. So we're going to see what the Irishman can do with Mr. Evans, who's obviously very formidable. but he'll be here giving you the exclusive statement. I didn't even ask him to do this. I'm very honored that he wants to come on here and talk about it. And obviously, because the fighting is just like one small thing he does. His real passion is fighting the New World Order and training citizens and others on how to defend themselves. But there is a lot coming up today. But he's in fight camp. He's driving over here right now. He's going to eat something. I said, look, you don't have to come around at 12:30. You can eat something. And then we're going to have him on air to talk about this. So that's coming up today. Now, before I go any further, I want to go to your phone calls. Got a lot of clips. Already played Congress subpoenaing the FBI live on TV saying you will give us your real field reports with Hillary Clinton, not the redacted ones. We are the purse strings. We are the main check and balance on you. Do you understand? And the FBI tried to say, no, we can give you what we want. Do a Freedom of Information Act request. And this is the judicial committee that is over it, actually funds the FBI, basically. He's like, are you kidding me? It's like having your 10-year-old kid. You come home and you go, hey, get your feet off the table and pick up that cereal dumped all over the counter and you know, what are your muddy shoes? And your 10-year-old looks at you and goes, you know what? I run the show now. And you're like, okay, well, you don't actually run the show now. What planet are you on? But that's what globalism is. It's an exercise of dragging us through the mud, training us that the servant is the master. And that's not how the cow ate the cabbage. I want to go to your phone calls, John and Junior and Haiti and Heidi and Daniel and Sebastian. And others, the toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231. Now, I said Nicolas Sarkozy's bad. He's a globalist, but nothing compared to Hollande. So notice as soon as he announced he's running for president again in France, they've indicted him. And now he says he's questioning global warming and saying it's a plan to basically shut down industrial societies. Yes, that's what it is. But don't worry, bizarro world, Hillary says she's been more transparent. That's a quote. I'm going to play this clip later. Than any president. Any presidential candidate ever. And even Lemon on CNN, Don Lemon, laughed when she said this. We'll play it later. It's up on InfoWars.com because it's just ridiculous. No one's been more secretive. Now they have the head of the Clinton Foundation coming out. We have video of this too, saying they are completely transparent. They use classic money laundering strategies that if anybody else was doing it, you'd be instantly, you know, investigated. You'd be indicted. In fact, these practices are illegal. They use shell corporations, dummy accounts, foreign accounts. It's all secret. It's And we have the emails. It's like, yeah, you give me $1 million and I'll get you access to the Chinese president. Wow. By the way, London Guardian, The Observer is reporting this. Guccifer 2.0, Obama sold off public offices to donors. And listen, this has gone on for a while, but they're so brazen. It's like, yeah, give us $500,000, give us $1 million, give us $2 million. You got the ambassadorship. That's a palace, your own guards, you name it, and all the contacts you can make in that country to make special money and sell your own influence for $1 million, or it went for different prices. Totally illegal. 110% flaming crime. And we have Obama on that. Maybe he'll just pardon himself. Meanwhile, I've got to play this clip, then I'm going to go to your calls. I'm going to play some Trump clips here because I never get these clips. These are gold. Then I'm going to take your calls. We've got Trump talking about the fact that Hillary could not sit there and speak in a room with 10,000 people. It's supposed to hold 5,000, and the temperature is like 115, 120. Hillary couldn't even stand there for an hour if it was 70 degrees. But Trump makes the point that she couldn't even stand there. And Hillary's nowhere to be seen. She does phone interviews now, but everything's fine. It'd be like saying Lenin is still alive, you know, even though his body is embalmed on Red Square. Maybe we can have an embalmed body. You know, Matt Drudge has a brain in a jar. Forget even a brain in a jar. You just have a, you know, dead body embalmed. Let's play Trump.
It is hot, and it's always hot when I perform because the crowds are so big. These rooms were not designed for this kind of a crowd. I don't know, folks. You think Hillary would be able to stand up here for an hour and do this? I don't know.
There you go. A few other clips I want to get to. Since I mentioned it, let's do Don Lemon laughs at Hillary's claims of transparency. And then we've got another clip here with CNN doctor Sanjay Gupta saying we still don't know a lot of things about Hillary's health and saying this is not a release of medical records. This is her doctor saying she's completely normal. Now, you know what that means. Somebody don't want to lose their medical license down the road because they know the rats are leaving the sinking ship. See, the confidence is being lost right now. So Lemon is a little backstabber, so he can't help but laugh at her. And her own doctor says, oh, she's completely normal. Well, if you've already got cancer of the brain and the lungs, and you've already have seizures every 15, 20 minutes, and you're totally bombed out of your brain on drugs most of the time, because just if you don't, you'll have seizures every 5 minutes. And yeah, that's normal. That's the new normal of being an invalid. But first, let's get to Don Lemon laughs at Hillary's claims.
I'm not going to comment on anything that is said in a private email.
And even to critics beyond the former secretary.
But I think I've worked very, very hard to be more transparent than not just my opponent, but really in a comparison to anybody who's run. You know, the medical information I've put out, and we're going to put out more. Meets and exceeds the standards that other presidential candidates, including President Obama and, you know, Mitt Romney and others have met. My tax returns are out there, 40 years of transparency about my tax returns.
All right, that's enough.
So I think...
Please turn it off. She can't even do TV interviews now because she's just somewhere secretively, you know, having convulsions. Yeah, her tax returns are done by big organized crime law firms that are run by former attorney generals and people. So you go there because no one's going to indict the former attorney general. They certify your fake tax returns when you've got all these offshore accounts and secret accounts that they admit are totally criminal. So, yes, we've got your fake tax returns. You know, good for Trump not releasing his. But if I was Trump, he always says, well, I'll release my tax returns if she releases her medical stuff. See, why should it be a one-way street? I agree with Trump. That's good negotiation. But that's not even what we're talking about here. Hillary Clinton needs to release her foundation documents from all of her Swiss bank accounts and Canadian bank accounts and Luxembourg bank accounts and Grand Cayman and Bahama bank accounts and Panamanian bank accounts, sweetheart. We want to see that. You want my tax returns when you've got a bunch of shady accounts, lady? Like, shady is not even the right word. Here is the Clinton Foundation president, Donna Shalala, says the Clinton Foundation is the most transparent foundation in the history of the world. Of course, it's totally secretive. All the experts say it's completely criminal. Nothing's ever been seen like this. It's the most brazen gang raping, but it doesn't matter. Here's Donna Shalala.
The Clinton Foundation is totally transparent. You can see our tax returns. You can see who our donors are. We reveal our donors quarterly. You can't find a charity in this world that reveals their donors quarterly.
Who the donors are, you claim, but not the money or where it went or where it was paid? Donors get the money in, and then you don't tell folks, but we have the emails, what they're getting for the money. State Department access, White House access, access to the Chinese president. Again, when that came out 2 weeks ago in the latest emails, I was like, I never thought of that. She's such an independent that, like, she plays offense and defense. Let's say 49ers versus the Pittsburgh Steelers. And she plays offense for the Steelers and defense for the 49ers, and then she never leaves the field. She just she puts on a uniform during the breaks and just goes on different sides of the field, and she plays both sides. I mean, I know we know they play both sides, but, man, she represents the communist president against U.S. interests. Arrest her immediately. We're going to skip this break. This is the world we now live in, ladies and gentlemen. This is the world we now witness. This is the world we're now in, where these con men and con women like Donna Shalala and Madeleine Albright sit up there and just spew disinformation arrogantly at people. All right, I'm going to go to your phone calls, but since I mentioned it, let's just get one more of these clips in. Which one of the Gupta clips is the best? This is not a release of medical records. Gupta, we still do not know a lot of things. You know what? We know Hillary's super ill. We don't even need to play this. I mean, that dog's already caught the pheasant. That ship already left the harbor. Train already left the station. Genie out of the bottle. But you know what? We shouldn't get target blind here, because we already know we're right, but some of the public still, you know what, one clip I want to play is Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton jokes about Hillary's secret server scandal, and there's another one here where Bill Clinton jokes about Hillary's health and then says that she had the flu now, not pneumonia. First it was heat exhaustion, then pneumonia, now the flu. And her doctor, once folks pointed out that she went and hugged the kid and said, oh, you had pneumonia. We all know you didn't have pneumonia. Later, you're having epilepsy. You got a brain tumor. We understand. We're sorry for you. As bad as you are, I mean, you see, you're getting ready to be Lucifer and the Grim Reaper are like right there. And we're like, ooh. It's like, you know, under the skin or something, about to watch you get sucked dry in another dimension. A big old spider coming in to have a meal. I still feel sorry for you because you look like a human. So I have that empathy, sweetie. I do. I mean, my heart's so red and pink and full of love. I don't like watching what's happened to you. But you got your zombie husband. You can hardly stay awake when he's on TV. Oh, Hillary's. Hillary has faints all the time. I mean, she never faints. I mean, so, I mean, we've got all this craziness going on. This guy looks like he's about to die any minute. That's what evil does to you, folks. Take a good long look at it. You got to serve somebody, don't you? I don't think he's serving somebody too good, because old Diablo always gets you in the end. And Faust could have left anytime he wanted to, but he just couldn't believe he was conned by the devil. You can't cheat an honest man, but you can cheat Bill Clinton.
Because he's so smart, he thinks he's got every angle covered. He's got everything down. It must feel really good to be a guy like that. Somebody who thinks he's bulletproof and immortal. He can get up there on TV and tell you that my wife, hell, she can walk both ways to school, uphill in snow, 20 miles through the Rocky Mountains. I mean, I've got CNN clips I can play for where they go, this woman's got stamina, none of us have got, okay? Hold on, excuse me. Let me just tell you, this lady is incredible. Let me bite my bottom lip. I like to bite women on the lip when I rape them.
But what about all you people that went along with this? I mean, how are you feeling right now? And we have this Bohemian Grove article up on Infowars.com, the latest hacked emails from Bohemian Grove, which is like the Democrat takeover of the Republican Party base, you know, where they think they can get the Republicans in and, you know, they can get them to have some gay sex and get it on video that they can then blackmail the Republican Party. And what it is a blackmailing facility, I guess is my opinion on that is a proper name for it. But Powell, email, Bohemian Grove attendees will vote against Trump. Yes, of course they will. I mean, more evidence that Trump is an outsider. And then they say, oh, he'll wreck the country. Oh, like you've done by design to parlay it into your global government. And now you're all screwing each other and China's doubling back and you're not actually industrializing the third world like you said you would. And then we get the UN documents and you actually plan to bankrupt the third world even more. You people are pigs. It isn't lost on Obama when he's there with a red carpet and Air Force One and six other airplanes behind him and hundreds of Secret Service to tell African college students, not you can innovate and have clean technology and blah, blah, blah. No, no. Listen, you can't have cars or air conditioning. All right, now I got to get back on this jumbo jet. See you later. Because I'm Obama, I'm black, I'm liberal. You can't have jack crap. But I have everything. All right, see you later. Because the planet will boil over, was a full quote. And you look at that and you go, man, the disconnect. Africa's got some really cool, beautiful country, great people on average, but just never got out of slavery, never got out of tyranny, never got out of colonialism. And then you've got Obama perched on top of it saying, you can't have industrialization. And it's like, oh, thank you, black father. I mean, he's the devil with a brown face sent to screw you. Okay, I said I'd go to your phone calls. Tim Kennedy's coming up. So many other clips to get to. But since I mentioned it, here's Bill Clinton. Here's the, I mean, I don't just say he looks like a reanimated corpse to be mean. He looks like he could star. If I was a Hollywood director that made zombie movies, I wouldn't just go with the average dumb zombies. I kind of have like interesting looking zombies. Like, what if zombies had high IQs and were just kind of like vampires and live forever? As long as they could rape a woman a day and, you know, snort cocaine or whatever. That would be Bill Clinton. He's kind of like your smart zombie. He nods off and things. He's got some problems. But it's the end of the line. Because you can run on for a long time. You can run on for a long time. Sooner or later, God's going to cut you down. And God's going to cut me down, too. But the closer I get to God, the less I fear death. Those of you that serve evil, though, I know, get really concerned, don't you? They're so scared of death. You're so scared of the angel of death. The angel of death is real. And I don't want to die. I want to live to be 150. I enjoy my life. I want to be here to take care of my family. But angel of death shows up for me. I'm not a haughty person. I'm not a person full of cant. And I don't think I've got all the answers, but I know I love God. See, I'm beyond these people, and so are you. I'm beyond the angel of death now. I'm already with God. And thank God I am. And that's why I look at Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton. I really feel sorry for them, despite all the bad things they've done. They're humans we lost. They're people we lost to evil, to this galactic scourge, this dimensional infestation. But once, and science is proving it, once we can absolutely have a clear understanding of this, even in this dimension, we're going to have such a better time of this, understanding how to stop these infections and not act like this and not behave like this and go to the next level. Okay, I want to continue here with Bill Clinton. I mentioned it. Here it is.
Now we know, after all the hullabaloo over this email deal, you know, it was for a year we were told this is the biggest problem since the end of World War II.
Oh, that's pretty damn bad. Finally, ship is over.
Oh.
Oh.
Finally, the Washington Post, their everlasting credit, say, I think we've had about enough of this. And
The Washington Post said, we had about enough of this. The official, and I say official, it's run by the Democrats. Washington Post, it said it was over. It, just like the week before Hillary collapsed, they said, Alex Jones is discredited. Hillary Clinton has wonderful health. She falls right over. He just walks around there conning these people who he hates. Because Bill Clinton is ugly. Bill Clinton is degenerate. Bill Clinton, and he doesn't like being out there with just a bunch of regular people, whereas I like being around regular, honest folks. See, Bill Clinton doesn't like it. He's up there just, he's got them sucked in. He's got them roped in. He's got them right where he wants them. And he's just lathering the BS on them. Here he is.
We know that what Hillary said about talking to Secretary Powell about it was true. Finally, can you believe it? They waited so long, they released that email. And we know that.
We put that out. Drudge had a top headline. There's Bill Clinton responding to us in real time. People are like, ooh, Bill Clinton responded to you. Bill Clinton had me beat up. It was probably Hillary in a parking lot 18 years ago. And they said, keep your mouth shut about Bill Clinton. I mean, I don't want to tell the whole, no, Tim Kennedy, but they got attacked right back. They couldn't believe I started beating the living hell out of them. I was like, what do you think? Four guys attacked me and I'm not going to open a big old can of Texas kick-ass on you? That's the thing about it, too. The times I got in fights that I wasn't 100% the right, I had no strength. When really mean, big men were attacking me, every time I threw a knee into them, ribs were breaking. Every time I grabbed them and slammed their head into a car, just their faces were smashed off. I punched one guy, tore his nose completely off. They were just like, what the hell? And I was like, you're not stopping this mission. Now go get in your Astro van and get the hell out of here with blood just spewing down over my face. And you know what? I loved it. Because it's the animating contest of liberty. Let's finish up with this guy.
Secretary Rice didn't do emails, smart girl, but our senior aides did on personal devices, and we know that Secretary Kerry did until the law changed.
Now, you notice he said smart girl. Guess who doesn't use email? Guess who never touches a keyboard? I have an assistant do it. I do not. I send text messages. It's not that I'm hiding anything. I just don't sit with a big old computer. I call someone on the phone. The old-fashioned, human-to-human, hey, yeah. We'll be back. Stay with us. Your call straight ahead. But only if you take it in your hand. The sword from the stone. Who are the Merlins of our age to bring forth the King Arthur to defeat the globalist and slay the dragon? Who can pull the sword from that stone? Tim Kennedy's coming in with a big exclusive. We're about to tweet some funny photos during the break. Like ran back there in one of the green rooms, and Kennedy was actually getting out of his boxing gear and getting into a suit. We got some pictures of that coming up at Real Alex Jones. The fight's been announced, but he told us that it wasn't supposed to be announced until today, but of course the guy announced it yesterday, but it's okay. He's going to give us the exclusive response to all that coming up here in studio. He's back there getting some lunch with Anthony and Shane Steiner and others. It's kind of a tombstone article here. Glenn Beck's bet on Ted Cruz, bad bet. The radio host's plans for media dominance and political kingmaking are faltering because he's a total fake. Glenn Beck, this is really like a political obituary. I don't take pleasure in this, by the way. I'm not in competition with him. I love Breitbart 2's success. I love Michael Savage's success. I love the fact that Sean Hannity's gotten more hardcore. I mean, I don't want my guns to be taken. I don't want to be forced to take vaccines. I don't want to live under a world government. I care less about being, you know, the talk show host with the most listeners on terrestrial radio. Now, it's just a fact that via internet, hands down, we are totally dominant. In a free market, we dominate. And we dominate on smaller stations up against, you know, big establishment hosts. But that isn't where I'm coming from. I don't need to feel big because I, you know, beat Rush Limbaugh in the ratings in this city and that city. I'm going after the globalists. I want to thank you for your support. We're going to go to Junior and John and Heidi and Daniel and Sebastian and others here in just a moment. I appreciate you holding. Where do you think the election's going? Are you worried Hillary's going to pull a false flag? Because as confident as we are now and seeing good things happen and seeing Donald Trump talk about the New World Order and globalism and reach out to Mexico and other countries and say, let's actually build real economies. As excited as I am, the spirit is rising. Liberty is rising, but evil is still in control of this rock. And so you're going to see major counterpunches thrown. What are those? We're going to your calls in 1 minute. Before I go any further, Solutions from Science is probably our oldest sponsor. And from Solutions from Science just has a wide spectrum of amazing products. They've been around forever, and the reason I love these guys is that they only produce the highest quality off-the-grid backup equipment. folks should really listen, because I wrote these words just yesterday as I was bringing them back on as a sponsor, just thinking about over the years what Solutions from Science has done. A lot of things can cut your power, including dangerous weather. Plus, you should move towards getting off the grid, and here's a way to affordably do that. We should put their website probably up on screen for folks. Solutions from Science is offering their new fast charge solar generator at a nice discount for my listeners. You can use it on demand in an outage, or just use it every day if you want to save money on your electrical bill. Here's why this is so important. They had a big summer sale earlier, and I've asked them to run the offer for a week or two more just for our listeners, because the price was really at an all-time low, and I screwed around and didn't get back with them and didn't launch it during the sale. I screwed up, so we're extending it. Half the time we extend the sale, it's because of that. But anyways, that's inside baseball. What I'm getting at here is that you can get it right now. So I want one of these units to be in every house out there, because it's just a great system. They got a whole bunch of different systems. Remember, too, solar generators produce electricity from the sun, and unlike gas generators, run silently with no toxic fumes. Go to summersolarsale.com. That's where you find the special. Summersolarsale.com, or call 877-327-0365. That's 877-327-0365. SummerSolarSale.com. That's SummerSolarSale.com, or call 877-327-0365. And then just in closing on that point, we are running a Super Male Vitality special of 20% off right now at InfoWarsLife.com. And it's just cold-pressed herbs and natural compounds that are known to naturally boost your vitality, energy, stamina, libido. In fact, libido is the easiest thing to notice. It's dramatic. And look, I was honest about it. That's all I can do, is just tell you honest stuff in my own personal life. I don't particularly like doing it. But when I was 40, everybody said, go in and get a medical checkup. When's the last time you were at the doctor? And I said, never. I don't go for checkups. You know, cut my finger off. I had to go get that sewn back on 15 years ago. But other than that, I don't go to the doctor. And they said, well, you need to go. So I went and had all the checkups and the blood taken. And, you know, the doctor, you know what he does. He sticks his finger, you know, where. I mean, it's not fun. The point is that you go and get all that checked. And the doctor was just like, well, you're all pretty good here, except your sugars are borderline diabetic. Not borderline, but getting into borderline. So, you know, what are you doing? And blah, blah, blah. So we talked about that. And he said, well, hey, vitamin B12 prescription. But he also said, how would you like some Viagra and Cialis prescriptions? He actually gave me two. I said, well, I don't have trouble in that department. But sure, might as well try it. I've always heard of it. It's been around forever. So I tried them. Didn't really do anything. Cialis a little bit. Viagra just made me kind of see blurred and like have a headache. I just don't need it. Super Male Vitality, for me personally, and that's what everybody talks about. That's, we don't even pitch it for libido. But just to give you an idea of what these herbs are doing, it is strong. And it is dramatic, and I feel the results within one day. And that's what everybody really talks about with Super Male. And Super Female, same deal for women. It is amazing. And they're just suppressing naturally how we really are, how we really feel. But when we sell stuff like Super Male Vitality, and the national media makes fun of it, we only get more sales. I mean, this is really good, high-quality stuff. We got a lot of their specials running as well at InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And it takes a lot of money to fund this operation. Thank God we have such a giant audience. But I got to tell you, it is mainly the Christian conservatives who are the funders of the show. I mean, we know demographically, statistically, and it just shows how that's why the globalists hate Christians. Because even though they've captured the Christian church to a great extent, even though there's all this corruption, the average person that loves God and loves people and cares six times more often gives to charity. International studies show Christians more often help somebody in need, a Christian. And it's not just some mindset. It's a spirit of caring about people. And I humbly say I'm a Christian. I don't say that on some, you know, mountaintop and I'm the big Christian and I'm the holier than thou Christian. And that's the spirit of the devil. I'm ashamed of some of the things I do, even though I'm a moral person on average, and people, you know I'm a guy, you can trust what I say, and you know I'm a good guy. But still, just because I can look into evil, just because I can imagine things, I feel, you know, guilty. And that's good, because that means I'm not going to ever get into all that. It's just these people that think they're perfect and they can do no wrong. I mean, they're the dangerous ones, folks. And that's the type of Hillary Clintons that think we're so stupid, she can be falling down having seizures and tell us she's fine, even though she hasn't been seen in public in days, since Monday. Since Sunday. I mean, big stuff's happening. History's happening is what I'm saying. So thank you for the support, whether it's Solutions from Science you support at SummerSolarSale.com, or whether it's the products at InfoWarsStore.com. This is all happening because of your support, your prayers, you spreading the word. So make no mistake, you are moving the world. You are Atlas. Okay, who should we go to first here? Again, if you just tuned in 40 minutes ago when I gave the number out, I said, what dirty tricks will they play? Will there be a false flag? What's your gut tell you? Will they try to replace Hillary? They're openly floating that idea now. Where does all this go? What do you think is happening? Let's talk to Junior in Colorado. Thanks for holding.
Hey, Alex. How are you?
Good.
Hey, this is Junior calling from FEMA Region 8. And just a little background, I actually was an audio engineer and got contracted to do a bunch of the Democratic Party events back in 2008. And I don't know if you got a second for me to give you a little backstory.
Go ahead.
I did a bunch of the Hillary events. Bill used to show up. He'd be a rock star. The women would just go crazy. So I really thought that Hillary was the one back then. And then suddenly got turned on to some of your documentaries and all that. And I got awake. And I just wanted to thank you for that. And I've been turning people on to you ever since. And what I think is probably going to happen, it's been a while since Obama has played the race card, and we haven't heard from the Black Lives Matter in a while.
What are you getting at specifically?
Pardon?
I was eating a sandwich listening to you. That's when I have my lunches during callers. What are you saying about Black Lives Matter?
Well, I'm just saying that we haven't heard from Obama playing the race card in quite a while here. And what is Black Lives Matter sitting on all that money that Soros gave him?
Well, absolutely. I mean, that whole thing blew up in their face. But now with the Ford Foundation giving another $100 million 2 weeks ago, it shows that they've got another phase of that coming out. And this whole NFL thing, not standing for the 9/11 victims, is kind of the reboot and the relaunch of that to make it look really sexy and cool.
Absolutely, and I just can't believe all the idiots that just follow along with this program that they're throwing out here. But for them to be sitting on all this money, something's got to come up. And if you ask me what's going to happen, that false flag is going to be with them and with Black Lives Matter.
And do you agree with me that it'll blow up in their face, but still they're so arrogant they're going to pull it?
Oh, absolutely. I think the day it happens, the following day, it'll probably be shown, you know, Soros funded it and the rest of the Ford Foundation, and people will just go right along with it, though.
Well, you know, when you look at comic books and things, at least the bad guy in most comic books knows when he's been beaten, and then he sneaks off to reorganize. These people just keep attacking, and that works when they've got the high hand. They don't have the high hand anymore. Junior, thank you so much. Sorry, I took a bite of my sandwich. It was too delicious looking over there. And I was trying to let you talk, so thank you. Great points. Let's talk to Sebastian in Argentina. I should have gone to you first, Sebastian. I apologize. I didn't look at where you were calling from. Go ahead.
Hi, Alex. I call from Argentina. And what I'm going to tell is what I've been denounced since 2011 in the United States Capitol under Bill H.R. 3783. In 2011, I denounced that Argentina has been engaged in nuclear transfer technology from Argentina to Iran via Venezuela. I made that statement on the Foreign Relations Committee of the United States Senate, and then Secretary Kerry was the chairman of the full committee of the House. So he led me to start that denounce, but after he was replaced for Secretary Clinton, and then—
Okay, so let me stop you real quick, Sebastian, because you should probably send us your contact info. We should probably have you on as a guest. I mean, I remember some of those hearings that were going on back at the time. But first, try to get off speakerphone so we can hear you better. And then explain who you are and the specifics of your case.
Yeah, I'm not in speakerphone. This is an overseas phone call. That's why it has some delay.
Got it. I understand. No, it's just real blown out. Go ahead. We'll just back off the receiver then.
Yeah, okay. Since 1997, I am fighting globalism. In 97, I was invited for former President Saddam Hussein in order to show me which is the real situation back in Iraq. Because in the late 80s, Argentina was transferring nuclear technology to Iraq. So I went to Iraq, invited by the president, in order to confirm that the nuclear technology that we have been transferred in the 80s has been canceled and transferred to Libya.
Okay, so listen, Sebastian. We're talking about false flags in the election. You sound like an interesting person. I believe you're telling us the truth. We'll put you on hold. Give us your email contact. We can look up your story. You sound like an interesting person to have on the broadcast, but we're screening calls in that we're taking calls on the election and on false flags and where we think this is going. But thank you. Get Sebastian's email and we'll contact him. Sounds like a credible caller, and I appreciate him calling in. I just want to find out exactly who he is and what he's talking about, because if I can't figure it out, I bet a lot of the audience can't either. Let's go ahead and take another call here. Let's go ahead and talk to Daniel in Florida. Daniel, you're on the air.
Hello, Alex?
Yes, go ahead.
Hey, Alex. Yeah, first-time caller here. I just want to thank you for the good work, man.
Thank you, brother.
So what I think is going to happen is they're going to try to control the narrative by trying to either assassinate Hillary or having Bill die from natural causes to try to garner the sympathy vote, or maybe like right before the debate, they can, you know, weaken Hillary's, you know, her for at least a day, and then either.
Absolutely. She is a dead political commodity now. She is like trash that has to be taken out. And so I'm just asking, how are they going to try to make her look like a bigger victim? Because they just admitted she was sick, she could be the victim. Now they've been caught lying about it. All their credibility is on the line. This is a can of worms.
Yeah, it's absolutely ridiculous, Alex. And one thing I got to say is Julian Assange is biding his time to release these other leaks. But I think
they're supposed to come out this week. They're supposed to come out right now.
Yeah, but like I think as soon as like he tried, I think they have someone waiting in the wings to like form a false flag on Trump or maybe even, you know, Obama, because they want to control the news cycle and they want to cancel the debate.
Well, they're openly talking in the Washington Post about having pneumonia until the end of October, but her doctor said, "Don't worry, it's non-communicable, non-infectious, bacterial pneumonia, which doesn't exist." So they just wrote that after the fact to cover her coming up to the little girl. I mean, it's just, you can see them scripting all this in live time. Thank you, Daniel. We're going to go to Heidi and Jonathan and John and others straight ahead on the other side, 800-259-9231. And then Tim Kennedy's coming in. They give us the exclusive first breakdown on his big fight coming up. We're back, ladies and gentlemen, taking your phone calls. Tim Kennedy is going to come in studio at like 8 after next hour and give us the exclusive on his new big fight. And I'll be honest, I don't follow sports just because I'm so busy, you know, covering the New World Order, but I do follow the UFC. I've been to fights, I'm friends with Joe Rogan going back to the late 90s. And so when they come to Texas, I go. I've been out to Vegas. I've been out to other major cities and seen the fights. I will be going to this fight against Rashid Evans. And Tim Kennedy's whole story on this is so interesting. It's an Americana story of this Army soldier, wrestler in high school, gets to the military, gets to special forces, serves all these tours. And then he has to fight these guys. They're all roided up. They always get caught using roids. He doesn't use roids. It's going to be a big deal. Right now, let's go back to your phone calls. Let's talk to Heidi in Virginia. Heidi, you're on the air.
Hi, Alex. First time caller. Thank you for taking my call. And please take small bites of that sandwich. We don't need you choking to death on us. I'm absolutely all in for Donald Trump. But if, in fact, the nomination was stolen from Bernie Sanders, why haven't we heard a word from him? He fought the fight. He had the supporters and the donations. Could he still be a legally viable candidate? Or did the Clintons give him hush money to shut up and go away? The whole game's changed now. Their side seems to change the rules every time the wind blows. Back to you, Alex.
Well, that's true. I mean, Sanders is a globalist. He's a socialist. He's a punk. He's a guy that never worked a day in his life. Didn't have a paycheck till he was 40. He lives in fantasy land. His wife goes and bankrupts colleges. He's, you know, got all these mansions and luxury lake houses and, you know, farts around getting big book deals. Now that, you know, doesn't sell a single book, but doesn't care. He just gets the money. So he's a fop. He's a fake. He's a joke. So, of course, he's not coming back to the race. Some are talking about drafting him in or Joe Biden, but the system doesn't want him. They want somebody they've known for a long time. It's a good question, though, Heidi. Thank you. Let's go to Jonathan in Georgia. You're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, brother. Just got started on the products a couple of months ago, and I love them. I just wanted to say that, folks, the product's worth buying. My comments come from what's about to happen with the International Monetary Fund. On October 1st, oddly the same time that we lose our free internet, if the yuan or the renminbi is able to come in as one of the reserve currencies, and the dollar loses its reserve currency status, it won't matter what we have as far as an election goes, because that will crush the American economy, bring us to its knees, and lead us wide open for whatever they want to do.
Well, that's right. The globalists have put us into a position of being totally controlled by fiat currency. We're in massive debt. We've been set up for a fall, and they may try to blame Trump for that fall, but I think the public's going to be too smart to do that. The problem is there's no currency yet to replace it, even though I know they have the SDRs, strategic drawing rights. And I think with America's will and with the president people supported, we could probably stabilize global currencies and then phase out of it. But I hear you. Huge things are happening. I'm glad a caller, you know, called in on topic to specifically talk about big concerns about what they might pull ahead of the election. Because, you know, with 53 days left, they're going to pull something.
Clear right.
What else do you think they might do, Jonathan?
If I still believe that the currency is going to be the way that they come in and shut down everything overnight, because that will create enough chaos in order for Obama to hold off the election. We got to get things straightened out. We'll get back to it eventually, but right now, here's what we need to do. And that is the beginning of the end, in my view.
That's right. They've been organizing for a collapse, getting ready. We'll be back. Stay with us. It's 21st century warfare we're facing.
GCN.
Third hour straight ahead. More calls and then Tim Kennedy. We're going to have the first response to Tim Kennedy coming up in about 8 minutes. We'll continue with your phone calls as well. I'm Alex Jones, your host. And look, it's important, obviously. Tim's a patriot, a listener, involved with us in a lot of different productions. And it's just great to see him with another big fight coming up, because we'll be able to reach out to so many UFC fighters, UFC supporters, and UFC fans with what's really happening to the country. They've even had mainstream news articles. Hey, will you print one of these? I forgot to tell you guys to do this. I see them all the time. Why are a disproportionate amount of UFC fighters conspiracy theorists? Because they're independent type people that are willing to actually get in a ring. They're not cowards. And so they know the real world. Intrigue, subterfuge, what's going on. They're soldiers, you name it. Oh, look, most of the UFC fighters are like Alex Jones. What the hell? Look at all of them. What's going on here? Well, because they're not in mommy's basement. There it is. Why are so many MMA fighters truthers, conspiracy people, and just plain weird? Yeah, I know they're weird. They're not in mom's basement. Okay, let's go ahead and go back to the calls. Let's talk to Canadian soldier. Worried about a false flag. What do you think's coming up with this election? Crazy times.
Hey, Alex. I just want to say you got fantastic products. I'm a disabled vet, and they were great. They gave me a better quality of life, just to let you guys know.
Well, thank you. What product specifically, have you gotten the best results with?
DNA Force, because I got I was in a hot zone, unprotected, and my nervous system's being eaten away.
So you're talking about DU, you're talking about depleted uranium.
No, actually, hot zone, meaning chemical weapons zone.
Oh, chemical weapons. Okay, hot. Yeah, sure. Well, listen, let me send you free 2 bottles of DNA Force, my friend. If you give us your name and number, we're going to send that to you because you're a disabled vet. So you're right. Hot zone's a chemical. I guess what would you call a radiological zone then?
And then the cost of
Anyway, sorry. You were plugging the product up. Go back to your political point.
Actually, you know what? They tried to start a war in 1999 in Pristina Airport using us and the Russians. We disobeyed a direct order from General Clark, head of SHAPE, right?
I remember that. They were taking Pristina. They were bringing the Muslims in. The Russians landed, and then they ordered you to attack them, and then you said no.
Yeah, we stood down because we got an order from Lord Jackson, our Brigadier Mike Jackson at the time. He said all units at the airport stand down, because it was a classified piece of equipment that shot down the stealth fighter, the F-117 Nighthawk.
Well, I'd love to have you on as a guest sometime. Well, tell us about where you were at the time and what happened.
Well, at the time, I was right at the airport, and we saw Russian forces, two BTR-80s. There were four left 25 reconnaissance vehicles, and a warrior was about nine pairs on top of it. And we shut down our engines right away because that's a sign of hostility, right? And then we got orders because we had the old 524 sets. So about maybe 16 of us heard the orders. And one of the orders was go through them. As soon as we start our engines up, they pointed their weapons at us. We pointed our weapons at them. And I was looking at some kid through my GPMG. And he probably knew he was going to die. But for like 45 seconds, nobody pulled the trigger. Because we all knew what the consequences was. Or was going to be.
And meanwhile, NATO was telling you, attack the Russians. When the West was illegally taking over that southern airport for the Islamic invasion to take over. Incredible. That's why they want robots, because they will follow the illegal orders. I tell you what, Canadian soldier, if you can hold a while, I want to bring you back on when Tim Kennedy's on, if you can. If not, give us your address. We're going to send you two bottles of DNA Force free and some other products as well from InfoWarsLife.com. God bless you, sir. Now, I follow the UFC. I don't follow a lot of other sports because I'm so busy following politics, you know, the true sport. And obviously this election, 53 days left, this is probably the most important election in modern U.S. history. Even mainline analysts are openly saying that right now. Well, if you look at what's happening in the fight world, it's just as historical, just as epic. And it wasn't supposed to get announced till today, but it got announced yesterday. But we've got Tim Kennedy here with his exclusive first look response here in Austin, Texas, where he lives, training right down the road from the InfoWars.com news studios. So I want to thank Tim for offering to come on here and give us the exclusive today. Tim, thank you.
Awesome. Thanks for having me. Well, so November 12th, I'll be fighting Rashad Evans at Madison Square Gardens. This fight has huge title implications. He's a former light heavyweight champion, moving down to 185 for the first time. And the current champion, Michael Bisping, the last time that we fought, I beat the brakes off him for 25 minutes. It was one of those fights where I could have knocked him out, could have submitted him, but he had disrespected one of my friends and he spat on one of my friends. So instead of just submitting him or knocking him out, I just humiliated him for 25 minutes. That's the current champion. So when I beat Rashad Evans, they're gonna have one choice. They gotta let me fight the champ. So what I got right here, this is my bout agreement. This is the agreement from the UFC for me to fight Rashad Evans right here in November 12th, Madison Square Gardens. And can I borrow your pen?
Absolutely.
Well, I'm just gonna go ahead and execute this if that's cool.
I didn't know you were gonna sign it on air. Yeah, okay, yeah. Here we go. Let's do a document cam.
Yeah, I'm fighter right here, so I'm gonna sign fighter signature right there over Tim Kennedy. And today's date? What is today?
Wow, that's incredible. So it's the 15th, sir. So even though it wasn't supposed to get announced until today, officially you are now executing it.
Yep.
So even though he announced it earlier to steal your thunder, it doesn't matter. You now actually did officiate it here on air.
Yeah.
You're always full of surprises, too. I didn't know you were going to do that.
Kind of shady that that he was announcing a fight before I had signed my bout agreement. I'm super respectful to my opponents. You know, sometimes people have things going on and I'm never going to pressure anybody to do anything, which is kind of what he was doing. I'm fighting because I want to fight and I'm looking forward to fighting at Madison Square Gardens. The first fight in UFC history in the state of New York and at Madison Square Gardens. And I'm going to be right there making it go.
Well, there's the camera right there. You tell them. I mean, the first time they're letting these fights into New York. This is epic. This is historic. They've been waiting for you to fight for years. You can talk about why that hasn't happened yet. But, I mean, tell him you're coming for him right there on camera 4.
November 12th, fighting Rashad Evans in New York at Madison Square Gardens. I'm coming to not only win but to dominate. I need to make an exclamation mark to the entire division, that I have been and I still am the best fighter in that division. And there's going to be no question that my next fight after Rashad is for the middleweight title.
And for those that have been living in a cave, you might go back to the fact that you were totally dominating the last guy. And then he wouldn't get out of the corner and then ran up. It was just like something out of a movie. It was so crooked. You called him out for being on roids, and it later came out he was.
Yeah. It wasn't a hard jump to a conclusion. Look, you know, how he's competed. This was Yoel Romero. So in the UFC, I'm all but undefeated with a very, very controversial loss, you know, to a guy that doesn't even deserve us talking about him. You know, moving forward, the only thing I'm looking forward to is fighting Rashad Evans at Madison Square Gardens, November 12th. You know, this is going to be historic, and it's going to be a dominating fight for me.
You're a tough guy. I mean, let me tell you, but I mean, he's no slouch. This is going to be a big fight.
Yeah, he's tough. He's well-rounded. He was a collegiate wrestler. He has powerful hands. You know, he's going to sprawl and brawl. He's not going to want to engage with me. He's going to try to hit me from the outside, you know, which is fine. Fight camp. I have a long fight camp leading up to this. I've been training. I'm in shape. I have 2 months to get ready for the fight. I'm going to go to Albuquerque, New Mexico, to Jackson Winklejohn MMA. We're actually going to bring some cameras from InfoWars to film some of my fight camp. You know, when you're training, you're training 90-minute sessions once, twice, three times a day. You know, there's one day a week that I only have one workout. All the other days are two or three times.
Which you're going to love.
Which I do like. I mean, that's almost normal for me. You know, but with those long workouts, it's hard to keep the energy up. It's hard.
Well, let's put the tweet up. We just said 10 minutes before you came on air when you were actually, you know, getting in your suit out of your workout clothes. I mean, you look like you're in pretty much perfect shape right now. You look like you have very low body fat. How in the hell are you going to lose all this weight?
Yeah, so where I'm at right now, weight wise, I have 25 pounds to lose in the next 8 weeks. I'm maybe 7-8% body fat. I need to lose another 3-4% and 25 more pounds to make weight on November 12th. You know, I use InfoWars products. You know, I use Super Male Vitality when I am tired, when I'm broken, when I'm, you know, trying to get, you know, just go home and be intimate with my wife. It's those things. It's these supplements that kick me into the next gear so I can have another training session and, you know, have the energy and libido to keep things good.
And by the way, this was never planned. I went to high school with Shane Steiner, who's a really good workout buddy of yours. And you guys have been training, I don't know, 3-4 years. And then he just told me, everybody at the gym really loves the Super Male Vitality. In fact, Shane first came here and really didn't like supplements then and made fun of me because I was still pretty much out of shape, still am compared to you guys. He's like, oh yeah, supplement, Male Vitality. He was a Superman. He comes back like a month later and he goes, I want a whole case of that. My dad wants, who's a world champion bull rider, you know, super good shape. He's like, you know, 60-something years old, you know, looks like he's in same shape as you. And because it's cold-pressed known herbs. I didn't develop this. The top herbologist, you know, doctor group in the country. I mean, the guy that, like, you know, the Hollywood stars all use his stuff. It's the best.
Yeah.
It's like sold in medical clinics. He let me basically private label his stuff that's sold at medical clinics. And that's what it is. And it's cold-pressed. But it doesn't copy testosterone. That's why you're able to take it and you were able to be tested and you know, and come up clean. It only gets your body to release the hormones you already have. And what I'm told is it actually blocks estrogen mimickers that are in all the plastics and crap. So it brings you more to your natural state. So here you are, Mr. Clean. I remember when Shane said, yeah, Tim really likes this a few years ago. I'm like, oh, yeah, right. He'll be a sponsor. That guy doesn't take anything. He's famous for them testing him and, you know, over and over again on any drugs. This is legal and lawful, but he won't want to take it. But at the same time, I mean, it is natural. It is normal. And so I'm just honored that you are taking it because this is, I mean, this is crazy. It's also good for InfoWars. A lot of folks are getting the product because you've endorsed it. I mean, let's be honest, though. You said it was just a moderate response because you're already such at peak performance. When you're really out of shape like I was and everything else, you really notice the difference. But for me, everybody says it's the libido is the most obvious.
Well, yes, absolutely. You know, you feel that I want to go home. I want to be intimate. I want to hang out with my wife or my girlfriend, my boyfriend, whatever. It is so significant and it's so noticeable. So even I just want the tiniest gain from where I was. You know, the United States Athletic Anti-Doping Agency comes and tests me all the time. They test me when I'm on this.
A few months ago, it was like, what, 4 days in a row?
It was unbelievable, which is totally fine. You know, like you dropped a video today about self-sustaining life. You know, and in that, I say you are what you eat. You know, it is vitally important that we as Americans, we have an obesity epidemic in the nation right now. We have to get connected to what our food is. We have to know what our supplements is or what are in our supplements. And what's in the things that I'm taking are real herbs. This is real food that I'm taking before workouts and after workouts.
Totally natural.
Totally natural to feel better and to be the most elite athlete on the planet.
And by the way, years ago, you and Shane were going out and getting raw milk. You were getting your vegetables from the Amish. And people ask what your secret is. You are out there getting the best raw food.
Yeah, I mean, this is the video right now. You know,
this is you guys farming. This is what you actually do.
This is here downtown.
And you take Boston, your kids into it. That's what it's all about.
Is the connection to your food, the connection to, you know, life and the hard work and actually getting that benefit from being connected to what's being put into your
body. I was about to say, doesn't something in your brain click when you're digging in the mud and planting stuff?
So, and then you get to eat that? You know, do you remember being a kid and you're working so hard to build that erectus?
But see, you come from a family of farmers, so that's why you already got it. So.
Well, thank God. You know, and now I just want to pass that on to other people so they can understand and get connected. You know, if you're hurt, if you're overweight, if you have injuries, if you're an athlete and you want to take it to the next level, start looking at what you're putting into your body. You know, right now, we have a huge sale on InfoWars. It's 20% off for the Super Male Vitality. It is because of the announcement of this fight right here and me getting ready to fight Rashad Evans at Madison Square Gardens. You know, go buy the product. I believe in it. It's the real deal.
And I mean, look at me. I mean, I'm no Ted Kennedy, but from 70 pounds I've lost taking Super Male and the X2 and other products. I mean, it's amazing. I mean, this stuff really works.
It does. You feel it. You notice it. And I'm still getting faster. I'm still getting stronger. You know, I'm still becoming harder to kill every day. It's just being and refining that
version. Even though you are like at the top of the Al-Qaeda and ISIS kill list.
God, I hope so. I need to kick it up a notch. You know, like obviously Al-Qaeda, you know, they said they're going to kill the creators of South Park because they made fun of the Prophet Muhammad. And they said they're going to come kill me. We're all still alive. So maybe I just need to get on the Clinton hit list. Because then I'll have some company.
No, well, I'm actually on that one. I don't want to be on that one. Well, I'm on their enemies list. I know that. We're going to skip this network break. By the way, do we have Tim Kennedy tackling me the other day? Because I want to pull this up. Because this actually happened. I noticed Shane was filming. And Tim was already tackling people. And vice versa. And then I knew. It wasn't even staged. I just knew. I saw Shane with the camera on me. And I said, I love Hillary Clinton. And then, you know, knowing that Tim would tackle me. I'm going to be honest. This is actually true. You tackled me. And that part didn't hurt. But your hair, like a whip, actually slapped me. You hit me so hard, just with the hair, pow, that it actually was like a bullwhip or something. Let's play that clip for TV viewers. And then we haven't told the story yet, the rotten fish story. Oh, no. Do not tell this guy to go do something. He'll do it. It was this giant, rotting striper. In fact, Shane actually tweeted where you come up out of the water. People think it was live. I go, hey, look at that big dead fish. Go get it by the dam. He goes over, gets it. All these guts are coming out. I jump in the water, and it gets in my face. This guy's not puking. I start puking. So that is some training, dude, because let me tell you something.
Wait,
I
was vomiting. Or stupidity?
Well, no. You didn't throw up with guts all over you. What the hell's going on here?
I don't know. There's something wrong with my brain, obviously, because a normal person would be like, oh, I'm covered in
rotten fish guts.
You know, get me out of here.
All right. They're going to love this online, but it's a true story. Let's play the clip of Tim tackling me. Here it is.
I like Hillary Clinton. You know, that's where I support. So, Tim Kennedy, I'm going to support Hillary right now.
No! And then 5 minutes later, he discovers the fish. Okay, getting serious, though. Let's get back into this fight, because a lot of times these guys talk trash. You talk trash back. You were undefeated until this case you don't want to go back into. But, I mean, I'm watching. It's like out of a movie where he won't get up. I mean, I'm on the edge of my seat. I'm going to go to this fight. Madison Square Garden is a great venue. Last time I was there for the RNC 2004, it's historic. You're my buddy. But, I mean, they're saying now this is like the most anticipated fight ever. We're not just hyping this because you haven't fought for several years. Why is that?
Priorities. You know, I like fighting. I enjoy fighting. It's a sport. It's a hobby to me. But where this country's at and where it's been for the past 2-3 years, actually for the past 8 years, has been down a road that if we continue down, we won't have the America that I love any longer. So I committed to myself and to my family, to my friends 2 years ago that I was going to start doing things to affect change, to improve our country, to improve, you know, even just on a micro level, the people around me, law enforcement community, military. So I started companies and start training law enforcement guys. You know, these shootings that are happening over and over and over again that cops are getting a really bad rap for, it really comes down to their training. So that's what I've been doing for the past 2 years. I have been working nonstop.
But I love the fact you're like the farmer warrior, or, you know, like George Washington going back to the farm. You don't care about the glitz, the glamour, the fighting is only a way to, I guess, be more famous, to be able to promote liberty and freedom. That's your real passion. And I've seen that. But if you win this fight, obviously, and then win the heavyweight or the championship in this, then obviously your platform will be even bigger to promote liberty. So I hope that I know in between your fight training, you're going and training police and going and doing missions and doing other classified stuff. I mean, I hope you can just not do all the secret stuff and the police training while you're training. I mean, I think you really need to focus on the fight now.
I'm committed to this fight. I realize the ramifications, the implications, and the opportunity that's going to be afforded to me when I have that championship. You know, when I, right now, I'm a top 10 fighter. I'm a special forces guy. I'm a, you know, Green Beret, a sniper, a ranger. So people listen to what I say. But when I have a huge gold belt around my waist and I'm the champion of the world and I'm all those other things, and I say, believe in freedom, believe in dangerous freedom, give freedom a chance, understand what individual responsibility means, you know, have faith in your law enforcement, give them the tools that they need, give them the training that they need, it will have such a more powerful voice.
It'll be next level.
And that's what I need. That is the only reason that I'm doing this. I don't, honestly, I win this title, I might even just leave it on the octagon floor because I don't need it. I don't want it.
Exactly. I mean, truthfully, you're doing some really important stuff behind the scenes. Your wife's sick of it, I know. I mean, yeah.
There are way more important things than fighting. But right now, it's going to give me the opportunity to give back to the communities that I believe in and to pour and use that platform to
I just appreciate you. You're so classy. We didn't even, I know you have these huge platforms, ESPN, you name it. Would love to have you come announce this interview. You gave it to us. Like last week, they said, Tim Kennedy's, you know, don't say it, Alex, but this is who he's fighting. And he expects the guy to say it the day before, but he'll do it, you know, that day the way he's supposed to. And Tim was coming on the show. I was like, wow, that's a big deal because this will be all over the news now. And so it really is tied to your message of liberty. You announced it here. Why? I mean, you're 2 minutes to the viewers, to the folks out there. I mean, we're telling the mainstream media, this is why Tim Kennedy's doing this. It's why he's fighting to promote liberty. This is his view of the world. This is why he's concerned. Tim Kennedy?
I want every opportunity. I'm going to use any platform I can to, you know, perpetuate the things that Alex talks about, the things that, you know, that I believe in about freedom. And so if it's using to, you know, announce my next fight at Madison Square Gardens on air so that people come here and click on this, and so they bring them here to InfoWars. It's so that they come and listen to what Alex has to say. It's so they learn and their mind gets expanded and they open up their ears for maybe the first time and look at where we are as a nation and how much trouble we're in. You know, not to fear monger, but if we keep going down the road that we've been on for the past 8 years, we will not have the country that I love, that I bled for, that I watched friends die fighting for, that I fought for, that I killed for. That country won't exist any longer. We have to change where we're going right now.
Why do you think, because I don't think it's debatable, if you disagree, tell me, that Hillary, Obama, these globalists, they want to mount America's head on the wall. It's like we're a trophy. America gave them all this power, but they want to piss on the free market and the freedoms that made the country so great. I just don't get why they're in control. Why do they want to make everybody poor? Why do they want to have total control? I just don't get it.
They can't. So individual responsibility. You know, the self-sustaining farming, being in shape, it is being self-supporting. You know, you can control somebody that's poor, that's hungry, that needs a phone, that needs a check so they can go get food. You can control those lemmings. You can control that mass, you know, but the deplorables, the things that they call us, the things that they call Alex, the things they call me, like those are people that they can't control and they hate us for that. They hate that they can't say something and we have to do it. They hate that I can go get my medical care outside of the government. They hate that I can go get my food and they don't provide it. They hate that I can go to a well and I can pull water up and they don't own it. They hate everything about me, about you, and about our way of life, which is freedom.
They hate independent, freedom. Organic humans. They want domesticated slaves that'll believe any amount of bull Hillary puts out. Looking at Hillary and last week, they were attacking us on ABC, NBC, NBC, MSNBC. Jones is insane. She doesn't have epilepsy. And it's like God did it at 9/11 when she's been working with Al-Qaeda and ISIS all these years. Bill Clinton, you know, blocked the army killing, you know, bin Laden in 1999. That's been declassified. At ground zero, it's like biblical. She collapses with a seizure, and it just proves everything we're saying. And it's like everything we're doing all of a sudden is like, just gold. Everything they're doing is crap. It seems like that spiritually these people are fair game.
I'm not saying it's karma, but you reap what you sow. You know, and when you've been lying nonstop at every opportunity, at every single juncture, you know, it wasn't just that she was at 9/11 on, you know, at ground zero.
Benghazi.
It was I believe it seriously had to do with Benghazi. All of my friends that were there, that were dying, that were fighting, that were struggling for their existence, people are picking up phones, calling back to the Secretary of State saying, send us troops, send us special forces, send us the Army Rangers, send us anybody.
And they were on the planes. They were ready to go.
They are ready to go, and they couldn't take off. There's only a couple of people that have the authority and the power to say no, and she's one of them. So they're
saying, they got the stand on order.
It's falling, collapsing. You know, it's irony's tough. You know, karma's a bitch.
She collapsed like the World Trade Centers.
Yeah, it's tragic. But
where do you think this is going? I don't think the people that run her, the Saudi Arabians and the Chinese, I mean, I've talked to former deputy directors of the CIA and people that say, no, we know she is a Chinese agent. And now we have her, I was told this before it even came out in the emails, that she's working for the Chinese president. I mean, if you or I did this, we should be arrested instantly, and we should. I mean, she thought she'd be so corrupt that they wouldn't want to bring her down because it would bring the whole government down. Well, you know what? Justice be done, may the heavens fall. How do you think they're going to try to strike back Tim Kennedy?
You know, Bill and Hillary have never had a real job in their life. They've been public servants their entire adult life, and they're worth $200 to $300 million.
That we know of.
Yeah. I mean, it could be even half a billion, if not more. All of that money came from where? Foreign governments. They were paying her while she was Secretary of State, Russia, China. So now what do you do? You know, their secret agent, the woman that they planned on being president, is now collapsing downtown New York at Ground Zero on 9/11. You know, they're going to be at a loss. It is going to get really ugly in the next 7 weeks. Ugly.
Well, I got to tell you, the military is completely awake. The police are awake. And they're not perfect, but they're America. And Hillary represents Soros and the globalists. And the globalists think that they're in the same ball game they were just a few years ago. They're not. They're now, the lights are on. The roaches don't understand. It's like we have night vision on. The roaches don't think we see them. I don't think they understand. I've always been a pessimist. But I'm being honest here. And I've even had Roger Stone on, who's a big pessimist. He says, no. We are running the tables on them right now. They are sinking fast.
Last week, I was in Dallas training law enforcement officers. You know,
our crew was there. It's coming out next week. It's incredible.
The video that you guys are going to see.
105 degrees, 10 hours a day.
In body armor. These police officers trained for 16 hours a day with 16. Rangers, UFC fighters, some of the best shooters on the planet, learning. They're there dedicating their time, their own time. They weren't being paid to be there to be better as police officers.
And I should have said 16. I noticed it's like early morning and then late at night you guys are shooting.
Yeah, we started at 6 to 7 a.m. and then we would work all the way till 10, 11, 12 p.m. a.m. the next day. These police officers were remarkable. But do you know what they were? Like you said, their minds were open. They understood what was happening nationally. They knew the shootings in Baton Rouge. They're connected to the San Bernardino shooters. They understood what happened to Orlando. They knew what was...
Let's talk about that and play the urban farming video. That is so key, not just to grow your own food. It consciously opens you up, folks. It's spiritual. We'll be back. A lot of military people tell me that when they're going in on a mission on helicopters, they listen to this song, Ted Nugent and Stranglehold. Have you ever heard that?
Nugent. That guy is... he's a fire-breathing American. He said last week, bunch of coffins on C-7 coming back. And he's like, hey, all you people that are taking a knee during the national anthem, can you point to which coffin with the American flag draped over it is the black or white American that you're protesting for? You know, Ned Nugent said that last week. It just like struck home with me. I had goosebumps. You know, he's
fire breathing. In fact, that's how you describe it. Ted Nugent is a fire breathing American. Can we tweet Tim Kennedy? Ted Nugent is a fire breathing American.
He is. I will never be on the wrong side of him because he and I are aligned in about 60-70% of the things that he says. But I don't ever want to be on the receiving end of pissing off Ted Nugent, which would involve like pissing on your country. So I'm never going to be on that end.
Well, I mean, look, I don't want to put down these stupid NFL players, but they're making hundreds of millions of dollars a year. One guy's makes like $10 million in sponsorship a year, $114 million contract, $12 million signing bonus. And then he's got white parents that adopted him, and he's running around saying white people are basically the devil, and then bitching, and then like 9/11. I mean, I could see, okay, I'm not going to do this, you know, the Pledge of Allegiance, you're not going to make me do anything. I mean, I don't agree with that, but I could see that. But what about on 9/11, I'm going to take a knee. No matter what you think happened on 9/11, we know criminals in our government worked with radical Islamists to basically to carry that out and stood down. The point is, how do you blame the police and the firefighters and the people that died and the heroes? What the hell is your damn problem? It's like the ultimate level of a baby.
Yeah, it was pathetic. It was disingenuous. It was everything that you're not supposed to be on 9/11.
It was shameful. I mean, these people are
embarrassed. You know, there's already five teams I'm never going to want. I love football. I love, you know, everything about America. I love it. You know, like barbecue, bourbon, motorcycle.
I love football too, but watching these punks, I am.
You know. Well, there's five teams I'm not going to watch, you know, and all of them had guys on their knees during the national anthem on 9/11. That's it.
But what is the point? I know it's all Soros funded. They now admit this was all manipulated, but what are the Democrats thinking? Like that sounds like the worst PR move ever to go.
I don't understand.
I'm making $100 million. America's horrible. Evil white people adopted me. They're so bad. I mean, what the hell is your problem?
Don't take a knee. Go affect change. Go enlist. Colin, if you want to make a difference, join the army. Join the police force. Take all of that power, all of that money.
You be a good cop. Show us how we're supposed to do everything.
As an African-American that just recently converted Muslim to Islam, why don't you join the police force and be the connection between the disenchanted, disenfranchised community that apparently you're trying to represent? Go dedicate your time to those people that you think you're serving, okay? Then you'll get my respect. Then
say what you want about the cops. The cops that work in these inner cities, that job, you could pay me $500,000 to do that.
Yeah.
That is a crap, and that is a bad job. That's dangerous.
$500,000? The police officers that are there.
$40,000.
Maybe. They do it because they believe in helping the community.
You know what I love, though? Obama and Soros trying to break the will of our local governments and our local people. It backfired. They didn't just give up and roll over the Justice Department and the UN takeover under strong cities. They actually completely woke up. That's what I'm saying. There's blind spots with Hillary and these people. What they did drove what was left of the police that weren't awake right into reality.
Yeah.
I mean,
no question.
In fact, the break hit. We can show some B-roll for TV viewers. Infowars.com/show if you're a radio listener. Infowars.com/show. And we're giving a sneak peek. This is coming out next week. Super powerful. 3 days. You guys are like 4 or 5. My crew covered for 3. 100 plus degrees out there. 16-hour days. You were talking about how awake the police are. And again, I never even made the police like the heroes. It's that now, as things get really bad in America, they're more awake than anybody. So then it's actually exciting. So
the police haven't changed. They are still the amazing top. I mean, they are the best Americans that there are. And they have been volunteering their time and committing themselves to serving the public that they swore to protect. It is just the media that has been demonizing them. It's been the attack nonstop from the left that these guys are doing the wrong thing. They're not. They have tried time and time again to do the right thing. And these police officers that came to this course working 16-hour days on their own time using their own money. You know, this is at Sheepdog Response. Those are all my instructors. They're there at their own will, at their own time, on their own money. I was so humbled to see the commitment by these police officers trying to better themselves so they could do one thing, serve their community better. That's all they want. They don't make money. They don't have money. All they want to do is serve the community that they swore to protect and serve. That's what they're there for. And they are trying their hardest, their damnedest, to be the best versions of themselves so they can help. Learning how to fight, learning new rest and control. You know, if you know how to fight, if you know how to put on cuffs, maybe you don't have to shoot that guy. So they're trying to get better at it. You know, if you know how to shoot somebody, maybe you know when
you don't have to. And the statistics show you're twice as likely to get shot, not even in population-wise, but actual per person, if you're white than if you're black. What's sad is the cops won't respond now, so record numbers of black Americans are getting killed.
Yeah, another good statistic is you're really, really increasing your chance of getting shot by the police if you're breaking the law. So stop doing that. Don't break the law and then do what the police tell you to. You know, if I get pulled over, my hands are on the steering wheel and I'm like, yes, sir, no, sir, whatever you want. I'm one of the baddest dudes on the planet and I'm not risking anything. And you know what? They're gonna do exactly what they're gonna do, and it's gonna be safe, and they're gonna serve and protect the community like they swore to. Don't be a jerk.
There's obviously in this country bad people in every profession, but the point is when foreign globalists bet all their money and hundreds of millions of dollars on a civil war based on going after police, That's exactly what Soros did in Ukraine 3 years ago, a civil war against police brutality. They overthrew the elected government. Now the country's in shambles. This is an attempt to cause a civil war. Okay, people? So there's no doubt.
The race baiting was, to such a degree, it was pathetic. You know, when you look at Baltimore, you know, in Milwaukee and Chicago, and you look at how the media was playing, oh, another guy was shot. You're like, oh, dang it. It was by an African-American police officer who was on his back while the felon who had just broken the law, which was his third felony, two of which were violence against crime. Dang it. We don't know what to do. They just kept on trapping themselves in at every single juncture, in every single corner, because these guys are good. Yeah, nobody's perfect. They're still humans. The police officers try their hardest to make the best choice.
Well, look, I mean, there are obviously bad cops, but and it's fun to sit there and attack them and go after them. But the point is, statistically, 1,000 people a year get shot by cops. Maybe you could say 100 are unjustified. 100 people out of 330-something million. And we got TB killing hundreds of people a month now. They're just letting in. We've got hundreds of thousands dying in car wrecks. We've got illegal aliens killing tens of thousands a year. No one cares about that. It's all about saying your police are bad, and that's because they want to bring in federal control, global control, they admit, and federalize them and turn the police. You think the police got problems now, folks. They want to turn the police into globalist officers.
Look what the Department of Justice did in every single opportunity, whether it was Albuquerque or Milwaukee. They look for every chance to bring in federal law enforcement. They want federal law enforcement everywhere. They don't.
Al Sharpton admits that's the plan.
They don't want local control. Local control means independence. That was the basis of the Constitution, was affording us independence to do whatever we think is right. They don't want that freedom. They don't like dangerous freedom. They like control. Control, it might as well just be Russia. Might as well be China. Might as well be North Korea, when you have the federal government that is taking care of the elections, that is coming in every time there's a shooting and making it a righteous or an unrighteous shooting. We have problems. We need to head this off and recognize that the law enforcement community at the local level is doing the right thing as best as they can.
And there's an attempt to federalize them. That's the demonization campaign, period.
No federal government and the law enforcement is the worst idea you can ever have.
Well, look at the FBI. They won't even give Congress the 302 forms from Hillary. They told Congress, you do a FOIA. Now, I want to shift gears back to Rashid Evans. You seem very, very confident. He's obviously a serious hombre. Let's talk about the fight a little bit more. Then I want to get into some of these video clips.
He's, he was an NCAA wrestler. He's fast. He's powerful. He won the Ultimate Fighting Championship TV show, then went on to some of the highlights of his career, knocking out with Chuck Liddell, and then becoming the light heavyweight champion. I mean, he is no joke. He's been part of the UFC for 10 years. There's not an element of his game that isn't dangerous. You know, he has submissions. He has submission defense. He has powerful hands. He was one of my training partners in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I went there to help him get ready for a fight, and he asked to fight me. I was the guy that came there to help him get ready for a fight, and then he goes to the UFC and says, hey, my old training partner that flew to Albuquerque to help me get ready is a good teammate. Can I fight him as my first fight at 185? And then I don't know what he thought, that I was going to say no to this fight, which is idiotic. Of course.
I think he knows it's going to be big.
It is a big fight. But
big? I mean, that you haven't fought in years. I mean,
I'm only faster. I'm only stronger. And I'm even more powerful than I was. I'm hitting harder. My wrestling's better. My jiu-jitsu's better. There's not an element of who I am as an athlete and as a fighter that hasn't improved. So he's in for tough night.
Start over. He's in for what?
So Rashad Evans on November 12th is in for a very, very rough night. I'm going to dominate him every single way. You want to stand and box with me? You want to bang with me? You're going to get knocked out. You want to go to the ground and try to wear me out? Just tap now. Don't even show up to the fight. No, if you're going to sprawl and brawl, which you know you're going to, plan for me coming forward like a maniac. I'm coming for you.
What do you do if he comes out swinging? Toe-to-toe?
I would love nothing more. I think he knows that his chin has deteriorated to a place that it is not sustainable to stand and bang with guys. He used to have a chin. It's not there anymore. If I touch his chin, he's going to go out. I don't see him coming and wanting to go toe-to-toe with me. If he does, I'm down to bang. I'll be 100% in for a slugfest. Whatever.
So your final message, bottom line, what's going to happen?
Bottom line, November 12th in New York, the first fight at Madison Square Gardens for the UFC. Rashad Evans, you're going to be dominated in every single way. You don't stand a chance.
Well, I know where I'm buying my plane tickets right after the show ends. I cannot wait to see this, man. This is going to be unbelievable.
I'm pumped. You know, I'm ready to not only win this fight, get the title, but then have that platform to talk about sustainable living.
But here's the deal. I don't normally even care about stuff like this, except I know you. I know all the stuff you've been through. You support liberty, freedom. You're doing this part-time. You don't even want to do it except to promote freedom. It's like you've got to win. And I don't want to go back to the last fight, but, I mean, the guy sits there and won't get up. You kicked his ass. Everything happens. He's talking about being able to take a, you know, pounding. Then he finally hits you like 10 times, not even doing anything, but you're bleeding. And they give the fight to him. That was just horse crap.
Yeah, it's bad. You know, it also demonstrated kind of, I'm such a fair person. You know, like I believe in right.
That's what I told you. I said, if this guy punches you in the nuts, I didn't hit him in the nuts.
He's going to cheat. I'm going to hurt him, and he's going to look for an easy way out. This time, I'm expecting that. I'm anticipating him to grabbing the cage. I'm expecting him to, you know, poke my eyes. You know, he's going to try to kick me in the groin if he gets tired. It is not going to change anything. Not a damn thing.
So what do you do with my kicks you in the groin? You just turn it off?
It won't matter. I mean, you can hit me with a baseball bat on November 12th, and nothing's going to stop me. Nothing.
I can't wait for this. I've been waiting for this a long time, I tell you. I want to skip this network break and play this clip. This is just a five-minute little piece of a larger 20-minute piece we're putting out that is just Tim Kennedy and the crew, and this is what Tim does on the weekend, out there growing vegetables, and they got pigs, and they're slaughtering cows and everything else, and they're running around getting milk from Amish, and they're taking their kids with them. In fact, Shane's a better dad than I am. He's actually doing that with his kids. I do it every once in a while. I mean, you guys are really doing it. You're getting back to being human. And what's exciting is you say this is bringing you to a next level of strength.
Yeah. You know, we as a people, the American society, just layer after layer of shrouds have been put over our eyes. We've just become so disconnected to all the things that make us a powerful, strong people. We the people, right? That people part, that is the most important, essential element to being an American. And for us to be strong, we have to be individually powerful. Like, we have to know how to change our own oil. We have to know how an engine works.
Self-sufficient.
We have to grow food.
You're a slave if you don't know how to take care of yourself.
Stop being a slave. Wake up, America. And that's what this is. That's what this video is. That's what the True Patriot idea is to be committed to being an individual that understands how to be healthy and how to be self-sufficient, how to be self-reliant.
Tim Kennedy, Tim, you never even plug yourself when you're here. Tell folks about your Twitter, Facebook, places our listeners can follow the great work you're doing. And you also will see our videos that we're producing with him there on his site when we put them up.
You know, for Tim Kennedy MMA, pretty much for everything Facebook. You know, if you want to learn about shooting, if you want to learn about how to be the hardest person someone tries to kill, go to sheepdogresponse.com. If you want to learn, you know, like about what I'm doing day to day, go to my website, timkennedymma.com, or go to my Facebook, go to my Twitter. All of it's the same. You know, I'm too old and it's too late for me to change. You're going to get the honest version of who I am at every single
time. By the way, it is honest. You've been saying some stuff that people take out of context that did that to me, but you're saying we do what we do. You know, we're fighting enemies and bad stuff happens. That's their fault for starting the fight.
Yeah. You know, I'm not going to change. I am a barrel-chested freedom fighter.
Freebird.
Loves America. Never going to change.
I want to play this clip, but again, ladies and gentlemen, this is a plug. That's how we find ourselves, and I skip breaks, and I do everything else. I'm about to do it right now. We find ourselves, take lung cleanse with all these allergies that are happening. It's just a whole bunch of herbs into an oil compound. You pay more at Whole Foods for something that has like two or three herbs and alcohol. This doesn't have alcohol, and it's like 27 herbs, and it just really, you know, calms you when you're coughing. It's great for your kids. We've got a knockout, speaking of Tim Kennedy, where it's just, you know, the same dose of melatonin you get in a regular brand for $19.95. It's the same dose for $19.95, but then eight other herbs like valerian and others for good, healthful, restful sleep. Sometimes I'm all wound up at midnight, been working. Like when Hillary collapsed last Sunday, I couldn't go to bed till like 3. I'd take like two or three knockouts. Point is, it is a very low cost, super high quality sleep aid. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site, or call toll free 888-253-8255. 3139. And again, I don't claim to be a Tim Kennedy. I don't claim to be, you know, in super great shape. I used to jog almost every day and lift weights. For 10 years, I didn't work out. I gained 90-something pounds. But with Supermel Vitality X2 and other products, it's helped me lose over 70 pounds of freaking fat. I gained back about 30, 40 pounds of muscle. I'm a pretty big guy. And it's incredible what Mother Nature gave us. And your purchase supports everything we're doing. But you heard Tim Kennedy, who I never intended to be a sponsor. I mean, he can have sponsors out the wazoo. He's got any sponsor he wants. And he tried it, and it really helped him.
I like it. You know, is it evil of me that I don't want Hillary's camp to start using any of our supplements? Because she might actually get a little healthier.
You know, we thought of that as a joke, send her some super film of Italian. People said, well, wait, we don't want to help her. It might actually help her.
I know. That's almost unhuman of us, but really, like, it affects change. I take Super Male Vitality every single day. I love it. My wife loves it. My coaches love it because I have energy nonstop.
I love the giggling. I mean, let's be honest about it. The most noticeable thing within days is libido.
Yeah, there's a foundation to being an athlete. You know, there's kind of the four cornerstones. You got to have healthy sleep. You have to have that workload, that hard work in the gym or every day and your job, whatever that is, hard workload. Then you have to be intimate. You have to be connected with your spouse or whoever you're with. And then lastly is nutrition. All of those are equally important. They all play parts in how you are healthy as a man. So for me as a male athlete, I have to be intimate with my wife every day, a couple of times a day if I can. You know, like, I have to get good sleep. I have to have that good work, and I have to have that good food. And these things, Super Male Vitality is one of those things that is cornerstone to who I am as an athlete and as a man.
I'm telling you, it already funds so much of our operations, our best-selling product. If the average guy would just get it and experience it, I mean, it's incredible. And then you look at the reporters, the work we're doing. I coined the term 360 win because if something doesn't have other people winning, and if you attack me, I love beating you. But for average folks, I want to do something like, I like making my yard nice. I like helping my neighbor have a nice yard. I want to help my neighbor fix his car. It's just like we're all in this together. And it's the same thing. I only sell products that, I mean, I go to the top developers in the country and I say, I want the ultimate. And they go, well, that's going to be cold press and it's going to be these 20-something herbs and it's going to be really expensive because they're never dried. They're never kept in some warehouse for a year.
Or frozen. This is the best stuff.
It's wet. It's wet. And then it's like wine. They crush it. They turn it into oil. They mix it. That's why whatever it is in the essences of these oils, yeah, you take powdered pills, it still does something, but there's something more when it's wet. And so that's why literal Leviathan fat ass lost 70 pounds of fat on this. And it took me years of doing it, but I was swimming 2 miles a day some days. I had a lake house then. I would swim across the lake 1 mile and back. I would get out and weigh 280-something pounds. I couldn't lose it. And I wasn't even, and it was because I was missing the key elements. And it was when I got on Super Male and X2 iodine that it all changed my metabolic system.
Wait till you see me on November 11th, which is the weigh-in day. I'm going to be 3-4% body fat. There's not going to be any bit of me but skin, muscle, and bone that is ready to do violence. If you want to look at how a guy looks perfect when he's taking supplements, when he's sleeping right, when he's training right, you know, and when he's intimate in the right times, you know, that is what.
Yeah, but you were in your shorts earlier. You look like a cartoon character. You look so good. I don't know how you're supposed to lose more weight. I mean,
I've got 25 pounds to go. November 11th, you're going to see this crazy version of an athlete. And on November 12th, when I actually step into that octagon, you're going to see an absolute demon of a fighter.
I'm ready. Let's go ahead and go to this video. It's a preview of it. It's up on Infowars.com if you're a radio listener. In fact, I forget the title we've given it, but this is Tim Kennedy on the secrets to being self-sufficient. Urban farming is going on everywhere. Strangely enough, I think it's great. Look at George Washington Carver and others. It's being pioneered by Black Americans in Chicago and L.A. and other areas. But urban farming, this is the key to self-sufficiency. Here it is. And again, I'm not going to narrate this. It's mainly audiovisual.
You watch this, you see us digging in mud, you know, shovels, hands are dirty, and you're like, why? What's the point? What's the reason? You know, it's fulfilling. There's nothing like the end result of your hard work and getting something tangible. Heck, in this case, something nutritious and edible, and feeling those nutrients and tasting it. You know, the idea of this quick, easy fix, the handout, the enabling, the entitlement, it's got to go. Like, this is it. The point of, you know, if you're an American and you believe in how great America was and can be, it's being able to appreciate the little things. Where does your food come from? Is it even food? You know, you go to the grocery store and you go and pick your stuff off the shelf or out of the freezer. Is there any real food in there? You know, it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful lifestyle. And when we pulled that radish out of the ground and took a bite out of it, it was so powerful with so many different flavors. Nothing like you can just go in a store and grab and eat. It's nothing like that. And that is just a tiny example, and you blow that up to this lifestyle of eating that way and feeding your body with these amazing, delicious, nutrient, real food, it brings your body to another level. So, you know, if you're an elite athlete, or you're sick, or you're having these daily problems or these aches, you know what? You are what you eat. Maybe start changing things up and finding and getting connected. You can start anywhere. You know, like, this might seem daunting. Like, this is a farm. This is beautiful. This is complex. You don't have to. This is not a starting point. It was for him. Sean literally just made a decision. I'm going to change, and then changed.
Rain.
So started raining on us kind of hard. Take a break. For you, my question is why? Why are you passionate about it? Like, why do you care about this?
Oh, man. When I started, I didn't even have an answer for that. I mean, people kept asking why. And I said, I don't know. I mean, I just felt this drive, this weird innate passion that was in me. I mean, I didn't have any background in it. And it's scary to step into a way of life that you know nothing about, but this, without a doubt, is the way we are supposed to live our lives. And because we haven't for the past 50 years, you can see the mess that it got us into. So if I can use this small space, I mean, this 1 acre space to inspire, to educate, to make a stronger America, to make a stronger Texas, and that is something my heart is completely behind.
We're coming to a point across a turn in the road, a Y, an intersection, that if we don't change, we're gonna be a dying nation. We're gonna have, it is not sustainable what we've been doing. This is a micro example of the bigger picture of what is America and how can America be great. It's hard work. It's sustainability. It's appreciating what you are and how you got there. You know, you are what you eat. And do it, we're eating crap.
Wow, I am so excited to be associated with the work that Tim Kennedy and Shane Steiner are doing, and Josh Owens and the rest of our camera people, Michael Zimmerman, are just absolute blessings. They're so talented. And now, let's get ready to rumble. I'm punching out in T-minus 4 minutes. And then Anthony Cumia, who has his own great network, I just had Gavin McGinnis on yesterday, teamed up with us hosting the fourth hour. Because these guys are patriots. He got fired off XM, top show on there, because he dared criticize our Lord and Savior, Hillary Rodham Clinton, and others. So he's coming up here in just a moment. Looking forward to that. In closing, Tim Kennedy, thank you, without me even asking, coming and sharing the exclusive today. Everything else is coming up. We just showed that amazing clip of the sustainable farming shows we're doing, shooting training shows, home security shows. This is all stuff that's just free on the internet, blacksmithing shows. I think I'm going to be working with Jesse James. We'll do some stuff.
Yep.
So much exciting stuff coming up.
You know, it's all of it. You know, how are all of these things connected? They're all about being an American. They're all about being self-sufficient. It's all about being individual and having the responsibility to take care of yourself and your family. So learn the skills. Look at the videos. Go to InfoWars.com.
And we're designed to do it, as you keep saying.
This
and
is like, how we were built. This is how we were made. You know, you take the right supplements. Get good sleep. Have fantastic sex. Work really hard.
Battle commies.
And cannot be controlled. You can't be controlled when you're free. You know? Good luck trying to, you know, make me a slave.
Now, don't run out of here to go train again three times a day. As soon as this is over and I hand the baton to Mr. Kumi, I want to go do a quick interview for the Nightly News. But thanks for the big exclusive. This is going to be big news. Anything else you want to say? Because this is going to be obviously on ESPN everywhere, you know, CNN, Fox, by tonight and tomorrow. Your response, anything else you want to say to Hillary? I mean, hey, they say she's so healthy she could probably beat you. How about Hillary Clinton's going to be who you're going to be fighting?
Let's have a race. Let's see how many jars of pickles we can open. You know, like her versus me. You know, like, okay, the fight November 12th, Madison Square Gardens, first fight in New York history for the UFC. I'm fighting a former champion. This is going to have title implications. That's huge. If you're a law enforcement officer, I love you. Come to one of our courses. Go to sheepdogresponse.com and come learn the skills that you need to survive.
Do I have to pull a string with Joe Rogan or Dana White to get a close seat? I don't want to be front row.
I'll get you to sleep. Three or four rows
back.
As long as you put your booming voice out there and cheer for me.
I'm going to be there.
That'll just take
I've just been front row, like, as Joe gets me, like, right behind the report. We can't see there. It's like, seems like four or five rows back's the best.
Okay, four or five.
Well, where do you think is the best place to watch?
So there's, like, the octagon around me.
Yeah, yeah.
There's, like, a referee in between me and the guy I'm fighting.
No, I know you're watching. I'm saying for me as a spectator. Okay. Oh, smart ass.
Inside's the best view.
Exactly. That's, you're something else. Okay. Don't run off. Anthony Cumia, what is coming up this hour, my friend?
The big news, Hillary's back. She's back healthier than ever. Oh, my God. I saw her walk up a flight of stairs.
Did you see her stumbling down that bus like she's totally dizzy? Like, oh, I'm fine.
I don't know what they must have shot her up with, but she walked up those stairs, looked healthy as a horse. And, of course, that's all they're talking about now on the news is this is the revitalized new energetic Hillary Clinton. She talked to the press in the plane for 2 seconds and then ran to the back of the plane again. So,
well, hey, we can roll oranges to her.
Yes, those oranges with little messages on them.
Yeah, as long as it's not over 80 degrees. Heaven forbid she has to be commander in chief if the temperature is hotter than 80 degrees, because then we're screwed as a nation. You know, what are we going to do?
I've looked at some maps of mean temperatures of the Earth, and there's two tiny slivers just north of us, and just, I think, the Tropic of Capricorn, where she could actually carry on a conversation for 15, 20
minutes. She's going to move to Seattle. Okay, yeah. CompoundMedia.com. They're doing amazing stuff over there. I just love to bring these guys to our transmission. Anthony, you look really good with InfoWars behind you. Thank you so much. You're taking over the good ship, InfoWars, my friend. So thank you so much for being part of the team, sir.
Dude, I'm honored, and I've enjoyed you for so many years. Thanks so much.
Good to have you here, brother. All right. And hey, speaking of you, sweetheart, I tell you, this is huge. I am like a little kid. I mean, you need to get your rest, all your vitamins. We got to have you win.
Yeah. No, there's no worries. I'm
winning. But you say you're going to win.
Yeah.
I believe you, but that guy's a tank.
I'm not a betting man, but if I were to bet, that's a very safe bet. November 12th.
I'm not a betting man, but I think I'm going to lay some manager money down on this baby. All right. We'll be right back with Anthony Cumia. Stay with us.
Oh, my goodness. This is a thrill for me. I cannot believe this. I'm on InfoWars. This is awesome. Anthony Cumia, been a fan of Alex for so many years. He asked me to do this, and I couldn't be happier. This is the kind of stuff I love doing, talking about the garbage that we're being fed on a daily basis. I do it on my show, too, but I don't know. There's a whole different vibe on InfoWars, and I got to tell you, I love it. I'm thrilled to be here. Thanks so much for having me. We'll start right off. Hillary Clinton back. She's back. Of course, Sunday, she collapsed at a 9/11 memorial event that was going on, the 15th anniversary. And well, if you listen to mainstream media, she stumbled. She stumbled off a curb. She stubbed her toe. She broke a heel on her shoe. The Secret Service literally had to drag her by her shoe tips into a camouflaged ambulance and cart her away to Chelsea's house. Because when a 68-year-old woman collapses, and is known to have previous medical problems. That's what you do. You take her to the daughter's house like it's the 1800s. And you wait for Doc Baker from Little House on the Prairie to show up. She's an ill woman. So we know what happened. Actually, we don't know what happened. Apparently, she had pneumonia, which was diagnosed the Friday previous to when she capsized. We didn't hear about it until she collapsed. And then her husband gets on yesterday and says it was the flu. So we were talking around here saying it's a new thing, flumonia. She has flumonia, which is brand new. She can make up anything, make up any name you want to call anything. There it is. It's here she is just kind of, you know, just working her way into the van. It's all cool as they drag her by the tips of her toes. She's stiff right here. There goes one, two. Her head is like a bobblehead. Now she goes down completely. They throw her in the van and take off to Parkland General Hospital where Mrs. Kennedy will. Oh, that's right. That was a different thing that happened. Just unbelievable, though, that this is happening. But she's back today. Her first day back on the campaign trail, as they say. She got on her plane, which was amazing because everybody was waiting for the video of her to get on the plane. They didn't know if she was going to have one of those seats like the old lady in Gremlins. Remember that, where she was going up the stairs? And then you go like this, and you slowly go up the stairs. Or if she was just going to be hobbling with a hurricane or something to get up the stairs. But I got to tell you, and I can only assume, they drugged her up. They poked her with cortisone in the joints and some type of amphetamine to just keep her going enough to get up those stairs. Because this was the first image we got of her after she fell over at the 9/11 thing. So they wanted that optic, as they call it, optic, to look good. It had to look good. So they had to have just loaded her up with everything. All right, Hillary, come here. Come here. This stuff here. Just do whatever it takes. Get on the plane. So she went up the stairs. She wasn't leaping, bounding up the stairs. But she grabbed the rail, and it did look bad. It did look bad. She gets on the plane. Now, on the plane is Hillary, of course. I would gather the flight crew. Hillary's staff. Joseph Goebbels. Himmler, her staff, and the scared out of their gourd media. All the media that is allowed the privilege of being on Hillary's airplane is petrified to ask her anything of any value. I believe we've gotten questions about how was your Labor Day. That was something that that came up. Just compelling stuff. So she's back from flumonia. She gets on the plane. The press is there. Nothing. I do believe they spoke about a movie or something that she watched or a book she read. This is serious. They are petrified to ask her a question. When they asked her about the Trump polls when she was on the plane last before she got carted away, she said that she wasn't going to answer that right now, turned around, and her staff looked at that reporter like, oh, boy. Oh, did you screw up? I was waiting for a Bond villain trap door to open on the plane and just have the reporter plummet to their death and then just add another death onto the Clinton trail of bodies. So she's back. We're eagerly looking forward to seeing her next speech to see if she could stand at a podium for any length of time and not collapse. Looking forward to seeing that. Other people that are petrified, Dr. Drew. This was a great story. Dr. Drew, you might know Drew Pinsky. He was with Adam Carolla for a while, and then he went on his own. He had a rehab TV show where apparently the sequel to that was the people dying that were in his rehab. I don't know how many ex-rock stars and actors died after doing rehab, but he was working at CNN. One of their medical experts had a show on there, and he dared question Hillary's medical care and her health. But he was questioning, what are these doctors doing? Some of the medication and treatment she's getting is archaic. So why is that happening when she's, you know, she should be getting top tier medical attention. So he dared question that on a radio interview. Well, again, you don't mess with Hillary. Oh, boy. Utenzi, he was done, gone. There it is. Adam Carolla, Dr. Drew. Now he refuses to talk about Hillary's health and jeopardize career. He's scared of the New World Order. He's petrified. Here's a guy who's had a very long and lucrative career in broadcasting. And he is now afraid to talk about Hillary Clinton. All Adam Carolla wanted, Adam's got a show, and Drew is a very close friend of his and an associate for decades of Drew. All he wanted was for Drew to call into his show and talk about pneumonia. And Drew got petrified. And then Adam said to him, look, don't even mention Hillary. I just want to hear what your take on people of age that have pneumonia. Nope. He wouldn't do it. And Adam understood. But this is the world we're living in. This is the frightening, petrifying world we are living in. And if you believe anything that the traditional mass media is telling you, oh, are you blind, naive, mentally disturbed? Because no truth is coming out now. And the media is not even trying to hide it. They are in bed with Hillary Clinton. I know it conjures up a disturbing image, but they are in bed with Hillary Clinton. They don't even hide it anymore. They don't even hide it. They're saying, we want Hillary to win. We don't want Donald Trump winning this election. So we are going to have some of the most biased reporting that has ever been done in this country. This is akin to the Joseph McCarthy commie hearings in the 50s, where people were being blackballed. If you criticize the liberals, Democrats, Hillary Clinton, you can be blackballed from having a job in the media. You must toe that company line and not insult the queen. And people that do find themselves jammed up, like Dr. Drew. But although CNN did say, oh, no, this was in the works a while. We're changing around some of the personnel here at CNN. So it's a coincidence. One of the many coincidences that happen when somebody says something ill of Hillary Clinton. It's astounding, isn't it? Another thing about Hillary that just recently came out, of course, the WikiLeaks, the emails. I love this. As if this whole campaign that's gone about a year, I guess, a little over a year, actually, isn't crazy enough. Without even the WikiLeaks and any, it would still be a crazy campaign, this whole thing. But then you sprinkle this extra, it's like an amazing seasoning on an already amazing dish. These emails come flying out every so often, and they're amazing to read. But then to watch the media scrambling to try and save their queen from any damage that these emails might be doing is another fun thing to watch. Colin Powell, his emails to a bigwig Democratic donor are funny. There's some genuinely funny things in there. Tragically funny. But of course, the media doesn't want to address it. Their top headline out of this was that Colin Powell says Donald Trump is a racist and a national disgrace. National disgrace.
Ah, yes. We're back.
Infowars.com. Honored. Pleasure to be here. Anthony Cumia. Welcome. And again, I thank you for having me. This is fantastic. We were talking about, of course, Hillary, her health issues. I was reading some tweets from Hillary. I don't know how effective Twitter is in the big scheme of things. You hear some people say it means nothing. You hear other people saying it means everything, that it's changing people's opinions and what they say. I know damn well over the course of many years that I've been using Twitter, I've not changed anyone's mind, and no one has changed my mind. So I don't think it's an effective tool in changing people's opinion, but maybe as a slow chipping away kind of thing, it works on the weak-minded like a Jedi mind trick. You will not vote for Hillary. Perhaps, but I can't see it really being that effective. But the politicians love getting on board. I think they're preaching to the choir, but Hillary has some of the most bizarre tweets I've ever seen. She will tweet things and you swear that they are against her and she's just taken out Trump or taken out her name and put in Trump's name. There was one today I read about Trump's health records. It was from Hillary and she said, Donald Trump hasn't released his health records and assuming he's trying to hide something. And I read this and go, how is this woman, when Donald Trump is running around like a maniac, doing multiple rallies a day, he went to Mexico, he flew to Mexico, had a press conference in Mexico. There he is. Trump on releasing detailed medical records. I have no problem in doing so. He still hasn't released them. And then there's a video about, you know, him and his records. Trump runs around like a nut. I love it. The man has shown nothing that would lead anyone to believe he is ill, has any acute problems. Okay, he's got a cute daughter, I'll tell you that, but any acute medical problems. But Hillary's the one that's been bedridden for a few days after collapsing in 78-degree breezy weather from the heat. And this is how the Hillary campaign runs. Find out what everyone's saying about you and then throw it on the opponent and see what sticks. And it can only mean that the people backing Hillary and the supporters of Hillary are either brain damaged or so naive that they're blinded to any truth about their Lord and Savior, Hillary Clinton. We were talking before the break about Colin Powell's emails, which are hilarious. The press has cut off every bit that's funny. I mean, saying dicking bimbos, which is a quote, there it is. That's funny stuff. It should be on the news. And it was said in an email. And it's pertinent. Hillary has her husband campaigning for her when she's ill in bed. So it does. It's not something that's just an aside. They also would not report on mainstream media that Colin Powell said he doesn't want to vote for her because of her many faults, her blind ambition. Doesn't like her. The fact that Hillary doesn't like Obama feels like she was passed over in 2008. And those are in those emails. And again, the media so sleazy and in bed with Hillary Clinton won't report on things that put her in a bad light and not even trying to cover it up for a second. It's embarrassing. It's embarrassing. And it's showing because America's trust in mass media sinks to a new low. A new low. What is it now? It's there it is. 32% say they have a great deal or fair amount of trust. 32%. And who are they? Who are the 32%? I always wonder that. It's like you read something that should be so obvious, and I don't know. I have no idea. 14% of Republicans express trust, down from 32% last year. Confidence drops among younger and older Americans. They can't get away with this forever. And it's getting worse, and we're noticing. We're going to take a break, but we'll be right back. InfoWars. I'm Anthony Cumia.
That is a sad song right there. My God, is that a sad little song, sad little ditty.
Oh, so I take care of business later? Is that it? All right. No, why don't we talk about that? Yeah, extended special. You're getting 30 to 40% off InfoWars select storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. Due to a listener demand, we've extended the massive 30 to 40% off special in our InfoWars select storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. Now's the time to stock up on super high quality storable food for you and your family that you can trust. I love this stuff because, you know me, I don't know what's going to happen. I have no faith in the world anymore. I want to load up and be the guy that's going to continue. That's going to continue with civilization after everybody's gone. And you're going to have to eat. So you want a food that has a shelf life over 25 years and are made right here in these United States of America. There's a reason that FEMA reports predict up to 395% increase in food prices that could trigger mass unrest. You see what's going on in like Venezuela? I think it was $600 for a dozen eggs. Forget about going to a diner. Jeez, you go broke. Start getting prepared before food prices might skyrocket. Get 30 to 40% off all InfoWars select storable food on InfoWarsStore.com. Do it today before this special is taken down. All right. How you doing, folks? Good. Back. Anthony Cumia sitting in on the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show here on InfoWars. And again, couldn't be happier. I love it. I watch Alex and it's just like, New World Order, here it comes. Look out, people. It's going to be unbelievable. False flag operation. And I'm captivated. And you know what also got me? The fact that his friendship with Jesse Ventura. Because I used to watch that Jesse show. He had the conspiracy show. And sometimes Alex would be on it.
Alex, what do you think about mind control? I believe the HARP system is...
And he's just doing that the whole time. But I've been a fan forever, and it's a pleasure for me to be here doing this. We got Tim Kaine, who of course is Hillary's VP candidate. I was watching Pence, Trump's vice presidential candidate. He was giving a speech with some Republicans, and man, was he good. He was really talking about issues and talking about Trump and what he and Trump, the vision they have for the country. And it really resonated. It felt good. When you hear them say, make America great again, and you hear the Hillary campaign bash that as if what they're saying is America isn't great now, it's infuriating because you know it means bringing jobs back. He's discussed everything it means, bringing jobs back to the United States, fighting poverty in inner cities, education, borders. Our borders are a disaster. Another thing he's talked about is making the military strong again, because he said the military is also a wreck. It's a disaster. And then the Hillary campaign turns that, spins it around to say that Donald was bashing our soldiers. That's what they do. They lie to you, right to your face. And the fact of the matter is, if you look back to the Jimmy Carter days, the Jimmy Carter presidency, and 1980 when Ronald Reagan took over, the military was a disaster. It doesn't mean Jimmy Carter was bashing the troops, or it doesn't mean Ronald Reagan was bashing the troops saying that the military was a disaster. It's who's in control and what little effort they're doing to keep our military strong and ready for whatever they might encounter. And Barack Obama has not done that. And he has made the military a laughingstock. When you have Iranian boats chasing our destroyers around in the Middle East, it's embarrassing. When Russian fighters are inches away from our spy planes in open waters, in open airspace, there's a problem there. It has to be addressed, and it never is, because Barack doesn't want America to be exceptional and strong and feared and respected in the world. He doesn't want that at all. That wasn't his mission when he got in. Oh, he's gotten some things done, that's for sure, since he's been in, because the world does not have any respect for this country anymore. Do we want to be the world police? I don't think a lot of people want that role, but sometimes you have to do things you don't really want to do. And since there's no one else to take up the reins, we have to be there. And I don't mean jumping into every conflict that happens around the globe, but there has to be a source of democracy and freedom in the world that people can look to not be afraid that ISIS is going to run rampant all over the place, that there might be a chance that we can get back to some civility. And these are the things that would make America great again. But if you listen to Hillary, she says everything is great again. So her vice presidential candidate, Tim Kaine, on gun control. I can't think of an issue I'd rather be aligned with than this. If you're an American citizen who cherishes your constitutional rights, which are God-given, not government-given, which a lot of people have the false impression that the rights were given to you by the government. No, this is a list of things that you have just for being a human being in America. They cannot be taken away, is what the list is. But man, does the government get in there and make up their own rules. And the Second Amendment, I believe, more than any other, with the first being second on that list. But the Second Amendment, it has been trounced by the government over the course of the years. And the past 8 years of Obama being in office has done a lot of damage to our right to bear arms that shall not be infringed. They just managed to infringe upon that over and over again. And if you're an American citizen that enjoys your right to defend yourself and your loved ones with the best possible tools, why would the government want to take that from you? Think about that. Why does the government not want you to have the best tools for the job to protect yourself with? If you're building a house, you want the best tools, don't you? You don't want to sit there with old Amish tools. Now, when you were a kid, you ever build a tree fort, Garrett? When I was a kid, I built a tree fort. And you'd get bent nails from the job sites. You'd use a rock for a hammer. You'd make your mom mad because you stole a butter knife for a screwdriver. You got the job done, but it didn't look very good. It kind of worked, but they weren't the best tools for the job, were they? When it comes to my life, I want the greatest tools available to defend myself. I don't want to have to worry that I'm not fit enough or strong enough. Or imagine your loved one, a wife or a daughter, has to worry that the person trying to do her harm is stronger or faster than her. I've heard this one, we're all guns. Let's get rid of all guns. We don't need them. And of course, bad guys, criminals, rapists, murderers, they're not going to give their guns away. And if you don't think drugs get into this country, alcohol got into this country when prohibition was enacted, and every other thing that's illegal in this country gets in, guns will get in. And the bad people will have them. And you will be stuck bringing a knife to a gunfight, which is could possibly be one of the scariest things that might ever happen to you. When people say get rid of all guns, how would you like it if you now had to know how to knife fight with somebody? Would that just be frightening? Like if someone's coming at you with a knife and you have a knife, I don't think my chances are very good. I've never knife fought before. I would rather defend myself with the best tool available. So the government has decided, or some people in the government have decided, they don't want you to have that. And it does all boil down to leaving the people powerless. Powerless. Fearful. Make them afraid. There's a sense of security when you know you're an armed citizen. A sense of security, less fear, when you know you can take care of your family yourself. You don't need an outside agency to defend you and your family the moment something happens. You're sitting in your house, something happens, and people also say to me, oh, you sound so paranoid. Yeah, read the news. It never happens. Oh, it's a 1 in a billion shot. You play lotto? You hope you win that? Yeah. The chances, much more astronomical of winning lotto than of being violently accosted in or outside your house. But for some reason, you mention that and you're paranoid. But you want to be able to defend yourself. They don't want that. They want you to be fearful and dependent on them. This has been their MO, the Democrats' MO, for centuries, decades and decades, and perhaps centuries, that they just do not want people to be self-sufficient. When you need them, you will vote for them. And that's why they keep people on the till, the government till for welfare. That's why they want you to be completely unable to defend yourself and your family. Because then you're instead of reaching for the best tool available to defend you and your family, you now have to reach for a phone and call someone, a government agency, to help you. And most of the times, they're there just to clean up and find out what happened, not prevent it from happening. That's in your hands. I see all these alarm commercials are great when a guy's turning on his various alarms around his house, and he goes, looks out the window. Not on my watch. And he's all secure in the fact that his family is safe and sound from any danger that might be happening. What if someone does get in? Not on your watch? I wonder what goes through their heads when you know you don't have anything to protect yourself with. You scan the room for a lamp. Nothing worse than a lamp to a gunfight. One thing worse than a knife to a gunfight, a lamp to a gunfight. I'd say odds are you're losing. So anytime you get candidates like Tim Kaine that are really pushing gun control, think of the bigger picture. It's not this lie that they present to you about wanting to make America safer. It's not the lie that they're giving you that it's to protect the children. What they want is you more dependent on them. They want you afraid. They want you to be afraid that you can't protect yourself and your family, and you will look elsewhere for that protection. And who is there to give it to you? Them. So you pull the lever for them in November. And that's what the deeper story is. So whenever you see somebody professing that gun control is a great issue for the safety of this country, it's just another lie, much like the welfare thing and immigration. Oh, boy, when I hear that one. Donald Trump is a racist because he's against immigrants. Oh, they left that illegal word out again, didn't they? Oof. No, it's undocumented immigrant. Illegal alien. Undocumented immigrant. It's an illegal thing they're doing. I want to make an undocumented withdrawal from a bank. I'm going to make an undocumented withdrawal and say, it's not illegal. I have no money in your bank. This isn't a withdrawal slip or a card at an ATM. It's a note that says, give me your money. It's an undocumented withdrawal. Is that okay? Oh, it's illegal. It's a robbery. Right. See how that works if you leave out the word illegal? Donald Trump, I've known many Border Patrol agents over the years. I have a great friendship with law enforcement in this country over the years. It's a thankless job. And especially in 2016, I can't imagine anyone that would want that job. Not only is it stressful and everything it was for years and years and years, life-threatening, but imagine you go to work, you're working at a deli or something, and you make someone a sandwich, and they ask for ham and Swiss, and you put ham and American on there. You made a mistake. You hand it to the guy. You now have a chance of going to prison. Why would you want that? Why would you want that job? That's the new thing of being a cop. And I'm not talking about bad cops that over the years have gone to prison for doing horrible things and abusing their power. I'm talking about good cops that are now in the crosshairs because of political correctness, outright lies, pandering for votes. Because, like I said, the police have a thankless job. The Border Patrol has been gelded. They have been castrated, not allowed to use any of their power to protect the borders of this country. Wanting protected borders is now some kind of a strange, racist, unpatriotic thing to do. When you really boil it down to just what it is, it's insane to think it's a bad thing. You don't want illegal immigrants rushing over the border and coming into this country. Now, there's subsectors of that. Why? Well, crime. Well, jobs. We don't want a job. Just vetting who's coming in, terrorism, things like that. But the bottom line is, without any of those reasons, it's just illegal. As a nation, a sovereign nation, you want secured borders. That has been numero uno in civilization and civilized cities and Rome, ancient Rome, all of these empires, borders. Because the second they collapse, you lose your nation. And that should be the only thing you ever have to say to these people that don't quite understand it. We'll take a break. Anthony Cumia on InfoWars. Yes, back InfoWars. Anthony Cumia sitting in on this last hour. Almost done. This went very quickly because I am having a genuine blast. Thank you for joining me. And I thank Alex Jones again for the opportunity to do this. So much fun. We had some real laughs over Colin Powell's emails. And the whole WikiLeaks thing has just been amazing. But there is always a caveat, isn't there? Our privacy is gone. Remember how innocent it was years ago when people didn't want to put their credit card info into the computer? Wasn't that adorable? Because it was true. We would sit there, and there was always a friend that would go, I'm not putting my credit card info in there to buy sneakers or something. And you're like, yeah, right. At first, I was kind of like, yeah, all right. I'm willing to take the chance for convenience. And that's how they get you. Everything's convenient if you're willing to give up some of your privacy. And once these things became available, we couldn't cough up our privacy fast enough. Oh, do we love putting every bit of our lives out for you to see on this? This is science fiction that we never predicted in movies or literature. The fact that we would be given devices that we would then throw our personal information out to the world of our own free will. It was always some Orwellian big brother, eye in the sky, government tyrannical entity that had to force us to give our information to them and make it available to various entities to use against us. And as time went on and it hits you like a lightning bolt, we freely just decided to give up our information out of sheer convenience. Remember when EasyPass first came around? It's like, hey, guys, you know that pain in the ass sitting on a line at the toll booth? You don't have to do it anymore. You whiz right through. Here, put this in your windshield. All right, it's convenient. Mr. Kumia, tell the court why you were going through this toll booth at this hour. Was it for adultery? Now things are just being used, and you were like, wait, I just wanted to get through the toll booth. Now they know where I was and where I was going. And then the biggest convenience of them all is this, because everything you had to actually work for and go out and do, you can now do from this with the one little catch. All of your information is out there. And you don't know if your phone calls are being listened in on. And not only do you not know, they probably are. Your emails, we laugh. Ah, look, Colin Powell, look what he said. And you're laughing as your emails are going through the same thing. It's just yours aren't as important or as funny. In time, they might be. Everyone is open to be a victim to it. But the one revelation I got that really was something is that Big Brother, the big eye in the sky, that guy on the video screen looking down on us, was us. It's been us the whole time, ratting each other out, videoing, putting stuff out there that gives up a neighbor or a friend. We're ratting each other out. We are Big Brother. I want to thank again Alex Jones and InfoWar for having me on, and you, of course, the viewer. I'm Anthony Kumia. You can catch me on CompoundMedia.com. Thanks again, and have a great rest of your day.